is a presentation of the National Hockey League.
Roberto Luongo has been on a roll since losing three straight in the first round versus Chicago. The Vancouver goaltender has won 8 of 11, giving up two or fewer goals 8 times. Antti Niemi has won only 2 of his last 8 games, but he has been at his best when his team is on the brink, and the Sharks face elimination tonight. Game 4, scoreless and tense for nearly 30 minutes, suddenly broke wide open in the second period during a Canucks power play parade.
Here is Henrik Sedin, looking right in front for a one-timer, score! 5-on-3 goals!
Now in hot water and hostile territory, the Sharks must keep their cool and hope to force a Game 6 back home, while the Canucks look to clinch their first trip to the Stanley Cup Final in 17 years.
Vancouver Canucks are going to take a commanding 3-1 lead.
It's Sharks, Canucks, Game 5, next on Versus. Welcome to the Stanley Cup Conference Finals on Versus, presented by Progressive Insurance. Game 5, Canucks up 3-1 on San Jose, and Vancouver, British Columbia is calm from afar, but this hockey mad city is ready to explode. This is where Canada won Olympic gold, but these fans want that big silver trophy known as the Stanley Cup. Hi, everybody. I'm Dave Strader, along with Brian Engblom. At this time of year, the teams that separate themselves, Brian, are the teams and the players that can make plays. Nobody's doing it better right now than Vancouver's Henrik Sedin.
Nobody's complained about Henrik Sedin for days here in Vancouver, and that wasn't the case the last round against the Nashville Predators. He's got 10 points in this series, and he's got 19 points for the entire playoff. That's number one. Nobody's got more. He had a 4-point night in Game 4. When you give him this kind of time and this kind of room, nobody makes plays better than Henrik Sedin. This was a goal he scored earlier in the series, so he's running on all cylinders. Sammy Salo's getting more ice time. In fact, he played 6 more minutes because Erhoff is out of the lineup, and he really made the San Jose Sharks pay. 2 big bombs from the point on the power play, both of them in 5-on-3 situations. Sammy Salo's leading a group of defense, has 15 points in the series, 9 of them on the power play.
You mentioned Erhoff was out in the last game. He's close. He skated this morning, but he's not going to play. Joe Thornton, who we know is not 100%, is going to play.
Well, there's no reason to play Erhoff because you are up in the series, but for Joe Thornton, he has to be out there. They're in a do-or-die situation, and Thornton has been their best player, bar none. This is the hit that he took from Rafi Torres. We don't know if it's left shoulder, right shoulder, chest. All we know is it's upper body. But when he's playing well, these are the types of plays that he makes, especially on the power play. And in Game 1, he reads the plays, and he steals pucks, and he scores goals. We watched them in the pregame skate here tonight, and he was favoring the left hand. Watch his left hand a little bit here. Starts wiggling the fingers around, trying to get a little bit of feeling. We don't know what it is. All we know as Joe Thornton has to play as hard and as much as he can. He'll probably have another center iceman on his line with him most of the night, just to make sure.
We know guys play at this time of year with injuries. Ryan Clough of the San Jose Sharks may not be 100%, but always gives 100%. And for the Canucks, Alec Burrows, he's the perfect complement for the Sedin Twins, and he'll visit with Darren Pang.
Right here. Squeeze the core.
The Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus are brought to you by Progressive, making it easy to shop for car insurance, and by Warner Brothers Pictures Green Lantern in theaters June 17th.
Welcome back, Vancouver, British Columbia. And the Rogers Arena, home of the Vancouver Canucks. This is Game 5 of the Western Conference Finals. The Canucks getting the split down in San Jose after winning the first 2 games of the series have a 3-1 lead over the San Jose Sharks and a chance to advance to the Stanley Cup Finals for the first time in 17 years. It was 1994 the last time the Canucks made it to the finals, that memorable Stanley Cup Final series against the New York Rangers that went all the way to Game 7. The crowd is on their feet, and led by Roberto Luongo, the Vancouver Canucks take the ice. Standing by with Darren Pang.
Thanks very much, obviously we know the other teams are really desperate. They got their backs against the wall and they're not going to quit. So we got to make sure we establish pressure, we execute, and if we do that, we'll be all right.
This whole city is expecting to party in the Stanley Cup Finals. How have you guys able to maintain that composure yet have the emotion here for this key game?
Well, we've stayed in the moment all year, and we took it one game at a time all year. And we got the final in the back of our head, but we got to make sure we're ready for tonight's game.
Alex, thanks.
Thank you.
So the question for these fans here, the next game in this building, will it be a Game 7 against the San Jose Sharks, or will it be Game 1 of the 2011 Stanley Cup Final against the winner of the Boston Bruins-Tampa Bay Lightning Eastern Conference Championship Series? We'll find out together. Ryan Kesler had a career-high 41 goals during the season. That goal in Game 4 was his first of this series. Patrick Marleau was leading San Jose with 4 goals in this series as the Sharks try to avoid elimination in Game 5.
Hal Jordan, the Frank chose you.
Wow.
Anything I see in my mind, I can create.
We face an unprecedented danger. It's headed for Earth.
Brightest day, blackest night. Let those who worship evil's might beware my power.
Green Lantern's light!
Green Lantern, rated PG-13, starts June 17th.
We're now offering large three-topping pizzas for $7.99 each Monday through Wednesday carryout.
$7.99? That's crazy.
I'm not crazy.
This pizza's worth at least twice what we're charging for.
The economy's still tough, and this is a great way to give customers value.
He's going with the long tongs.
Would have gone short tongs, but he's a pro.
Montreal steak, unbelievable flavor.
With the mouth-watering flavor of Grillmates, you can grill like an expert. McCormick Grillmates. Master the flame. Master the flavor.
When fire was discovered, people got together. Then they invented the wheel. When more people got together, they invented houses so they could live together. Clothing to mix and match together. To get together at night, they invented light. And over a century ago, we invented Bacardi. To bring it all together.
Losing weight clicked for me when I realized that Weight Watchers Online was for guys, too. I'm like, it's not rainbows and lollipops.
After I read this beer cheat sheet, I knew what the difference was between a light beer and a dark beer as far as points go.
I use the grilling cheat sheet, drag it over onto the grill, and it gives you a point value.
This is a plan for men.
I lost 109 pounds.
Oh, man, you're on Weight Watchers Online. That's funny. And I go, really? I look a lot better than you right now.
Ah! Hurry, join for free today. Weight Watchers Online for men. Finally, losing weight clicks.
This is the Nexus S4G, the first phone that's Googled to the core with Sprint's super fast 4G speed. A phone this powerful can do almost anything. So now, we can fill the internet with even more cats. With 4G speed, the latest version of Android, and the best Google apps, cats can be searched, watched, and shared faster than ever. The Nexus S4G, only from Sprint, America's favorite 4G network.
Different. That's why there are 5 new Civics. The next generation Civic. Only from Honda.
Before you can cross the finish line or savor the taste of victory, you gotta make the cut. Indy 500 Carb Day, Friday at 11.
Back inside Rogers Arena for Game 5 of the Western Conference Final. Dave Strader along with Brian Engblom of the broadcast booth. Of course, Darren Pang is our man inside the glass down at ice level as we take a look at the goaltenders and their numbers so far in this series. And for Antti Niemi, not great numbers. Of course, he didn't have a lot of help in Game 4 with all those 5-on-3 power plays against him. And at the other end, Roberto Luongo. And there you see his terrific numbers so far in this series. Referees are Stephen Walkham and Steve Kozari, Jay Scharers, and Greg Dvorsky are the linesmen. players are ready as Henrik Sedin wins the opening faceoff back to Edler. Daniel Sedin plays it in deep. Here is Huskins, took a quick look, took a hit. Pavelski now has it bounce off his stick, picked up by Henrik Sedin. Doubles it down low. Daniel put it right in front off of Huskins. Burrows gets it back to Daniel Sedin. Fitch coming out in front. Hangs on, waits, now feathers the pass to Henrik, and he hit the side of the net. These two starting off right where they left off.
This is not the start that San Jose needs. They don't want the Sedin twins handling the puck like that and pull themselves. Look at another turnover inside the line, but they get it back.
Huskins gets it back, starts it down the ice, and he'll hammer the puck down behind Luongo. Now Marlowe coming out here on a line with Thornton and Couture. You were watching our pregame show here on Versus. You heard Logan Couture talk to Darren Pang about playing on this line with Marlowe and Thornton. What a great opportunity it is, and it's something that has happened earlier in the season. Tom McClellan, the head coach of the Sharks, had put these three together before. As Douglas Murray plays it ahead, knocks down one of the Vancouver Canucks, but the puck recovered by Mason Raymond. He tries to spin away from Thornton out at the line, held in by Murray, who sends it in deep. Now Logan Couture hands it off for Thornton, knocked off of his stick.
Good job by Murray. Three good keepings on the left point.
Now it's Boyle coming down from the right side. Takes a shove, but still controls the puck. Hands it off now to Marlowe. He'll shovel it along for Joe Thornton. Goes back to Marlowe with a shot blocker save made by Luongo.
Joe Thornton moving the puck more quickly.
Here's a chance. Oh. Save! Rebound opportunity. It's underneath Luongo in the blue paint. First the save on Marlowe and then the cover up on the attempt by Thornton.
What a brilliant save by Luongo. As San Jose did get something going, it was the big line with Couture, Marlowe, and Thornton doing a nice job of keeping the puck inside the zone, and in really poor coverage. Marlowe had a lot more time in front of the net than he realized, and then Jumbo Joe Thornton gets a second chance. Luongo with two big saves there.
Oh!
Thornton didn't get a lot of that one, and it makes me think, you wonder if he had two good arms, whether that one would have been a better shot.
That went off the right groin of Luongo. He stretched into his left, and he got it on the inside thigh of his right leg.
But you're taking the draw here, Panger.
As you mentioned, though, in the warm-up, Brian, you were talking about Joe constantly shaking around his one hand, his paw, getting that feeling for what reason. He did the same thing coming over to the bench as well. Just kind of shaking it, just kind of feeling it around.
Yeah.
Hanson tries to clear, held in by Baleen. Now it's picked up by Mitchell. Quick shot here into the glove of Luongo. And now let's go inside the glass, presented by BlackBerry with Darren Pang.
Dave, thanks very much. We talk an awful lot about Big Joe Thornton and the injury that he has and the fact that their backs are against the wall in San Jose. So one guy that's going to have to be one of the top three stars in this game is going to be the very resilient Antti Niemi. As you go round by round against Los Angeles, hold a couple of times. Against Detroit, absolutely brilliant. And, of course, the numbers inflated here against the Vancouver Canucks in the Western Conference Finals.
Well, you'd have to think, if he didn't have a Stanley Cup on his resume and wasn't such a battler, that we would be hearing an awful lot more about those numbers, Banger. It's amazing. We seem to hear more, especially up here in Canada, about Luongo. As Oreskovich gets a shot that goes just wide, deflected by Niemi.
Luongo can't do anything well. In terms of the criticism that he gets. Wins a gold medal on home ice. He's got the Canucks to the Western Conference Finals. He's played brilliantly in this series. His last 10, 11 games, outstanding. Yep. And I thought he was phenomenal in the last game. Just rock solid, never made an error.
And Alain Vigneault, his coach, came to his defense the other day. He was saying to the press, why no questions about Roberto Luongo? You only ask me stuff about Luongo when he gives up a bad goal, in your opinion. So I thought that was pretty good stuff from Alain Vigneault.
Played ahead by Klo, but it deflects up into the Vancouver bench and out of play as we get to our Pizza Hut favorite matchup. As we take a look at the numbers that we talked about a little bit, the last 11 games for Luongo, this is since he lost three straight in the Chicago series. Look at those numbers. Eight times given up two goals against or fewer, and the last eight games for Niemi, really a struggle.
And that was a watershed mark, wasn't it? Everybody was talking about Luongo not starting that game and Schneider going in, and look at how it's turned out for Vancouver. Everything totally and completely positive since that point.
Yep. Lead pass now for Kessler across the line. Knocked away by Couture, but held in by Ham, who slides it across. Higgins will get to it. But it's taken away by Murray. Just did get it off a stick and out to center ice, but turned right back by Mason Raymond. Little self pass, a little chip to try to use that outside speed. And now Douglas Murray hands it off, and Marlow saw Ham Hughes coming.
Now good communication from the San Jose bench, telling him to keep his head up.
Gordon sets it across. Here's Couture. Snapshot save. Luongo cleared the rebound himself to the far side, and here's the crowd chant of Lou for Luongo.
That was nice puck movement through the neutral zone and then getting it off onto the wing. Shots on the attack will be important for San Jose. If they just try to establish their down low presence, you can't always get that against a very effective Vancouver defense and a forward group that comes back and helps out big time in their zone.
Only change for Vancouver up front. Alexander Bolduc is scratched and Oreskovich is back in after being a healthy scratch in game four. Edler wraps it around on the near side. Rafi Torres is there. He's challenged by Wellwood. Now Mitchell pushes it along in deep. Edler for Salo. Salo, who had those two 5-on-3 goals, along with the 5-on-3 tally by Kessler that started things off. The puck goes in wide of Luongo. Picked up by Jamal Mayers. Mayers circling the net. Gets it back on the forehand and deflected wide of Luongo. Christopher Tanev, a big hit there by McGinn, of course. A lot of discussion about his hits in game three of this series. This will be an icing call.
And you go to Roberto Luongo in that last game, and I think his balance and his position was exceptional. On the road in a hostile environment, coming off of a loss in San Jose, and Roberto Luongo stood tall. You know, keep in mind that the chances for and against, you know, favored the San Jose Sharks in that game. Vancouver, guys, 13 shots on goal. That was it.
Yeah.
You talk to the coaches. They, you know, Todd McClellan had to go through his team and say, listen, let's just show you the chances that we gave up. So you feel real positively about what happened. Have a good mindset coming to this one. They played awfully well.
Even the Vancouver coaches had the scoring chances 13-7 for San Jose.
That's not a whole lot in either side. You know,
exactly.
That still goes to show you that when you score three power play goals, happen to be 5-on-3s, in a minute and 55, I mean, that's the hockey game. That's all she wrote. And the five power plays by San Jose, that they got nothing going.
A turnover by the Sharks. Recovered by Couture. Nope. Nason Raymond took it back. Ham Hughes with a shot through traffic. That was blocked out in front of Niemi. Comes back to the left point. Ham Hughes again. Slides it across. Bieksa angles it off the end board. Picked up by Kessler. Tries to jam it in on Niemi, who was strong down low and was able to keep it from crossing the goal line.
Well, good cover up there by Antti Niemi. Kessler tried to jam it in from the short side. Pressure from the Vancouver Canucks. They use the walls. They know they're building well. Nice turnover there. Kessler seemed to lose his footing there thanks to Douglas Murray. Now watch Dan Boyle here. Dan Boyle's going to do a good job in front of the net. But prior to that, when he had the puck on his stick and he turned around and was really forced by Higgins to give the puck up, I think Dan Boyle's got to make quicker plays. He's got to get it to his forward because they're not letting him turn around and hold on to the puck the way he wants to. And Boyle's a very important part of things offensively for the San Jose Sharks.
Pavelski, Setoguchi, and Klo now. As Edler plays it on the far side, Klo will get to it. Sends it back in deep. Edler there for the Canucks. Has it knocked off his stick, but recovers to play it ahead. And now Burrows with the Sedin twins on the attack into the San Jose zone. Klo with Daniel Sedin on his back, and Klo gave it back, and Daniel Sedin has it now. He turns, fires it right through the goal mouth off the far boards. Salo got to it for the Canucks. Now around on the near side, Setoguchi sends it across to Pavelski from center ice. He'll send it all the way back into the Vancouver zone.
Well, Joe Pavelski has Klo and Setoguchi on his wings. That should give him a chance to have more offensive opportunities, and San Jose needs more from Pavelski.
Icing here against Vancouver.
We'll go back to Dan Boyle again, and you can see the pressure that Vancouver Canucks will put on. There's Boyle. See that? He looks up, and they collapse right down on him right away. They don't want Dan Boyle to have the puck a lot. He looks up the ice, and he doesn't have anybody to throw it to, but he's done that so much in this series. They just stay on him. They get him facing his end of the ice more than the Vancouver end of the ice. That's a huge advantage for Vancouver.
Boy, that guy, he was real upset after that last game. In fact, went back home after the afternoon NBC game and watched the game over to reevaluate, to watch it again, to see the mistakes, see what the good things were being done. A lot of guys after a loss don't want to do that.
Now Tanev for the Canucks going against this third line for the San Jose Sharks. You guys have both talked about the line changes mainly on the top two lines, but the guy with the puck, Danny Heatley, is down to the third line along with Wellwood and Mitchell. Regardless of where number 15 plays, Brian Engvall, the Sharks need something from Heatley.
Yeah, he's going to have to use his anticipation. He's not moving all that well in this series, so that means he's going to have to use his hockey IQ and maybe even almost cheat a little on plays because they need some offense from him.
Now LaPierre takes it wide for Vancouver. Huskins knocks it off the stick. Robbie Torres is there. He gives it around on the near side.
Is a better word anticipate, Brian?
Whatever it takes at this point. It's do or die. They need something from him.
There's no question about that. 31 playoff games for the San Jose Sharks for Danny and just 5 goals, and one of them being a power play goal. It was a 5-on-3 and a 7-2 loss to Chicago last year in the conference final. That's not enough. And Heatley's got to know that more than anybody.
Now the puck comes free. It's picked up by the Canucks captain, Henrik Sedin, who flips it in wide to Niemi. And there's always focus if you're a star player that's struggling, especially if you're making $7.5 million. Centering pass.
Still feeling it. The Sedin twins in their very first shift set the tempo for Vancouver. This is another shift for them. Good entry into the zone. A turnover. Daniel doing a nice job. They'll end up with it 22-33. And then 33 out to 14. They make you watch them so much you forget that there's another guy on the line, Panger.
And you think of the goal that Burrow scored in game 4 where Sedin makes a great play and slides it between the legs of Niemi. Whether it's a shot or a pass, it really doesn't matter. But an easy one. Burrow feeds off it. He's got one knee, the right knee on the ice. He's got a stick on the ice. He's got a target. Makes no mistake whatsoever with that empty netter on the far side.
It's one thing to say anybody could play with those two guys, but Burrows really is the perfect complement.
He knows how to finish. He knows how to get open. He also will go in the corners and turn pucks over for those two. It's a perfect complement.
Now Higgins with a shot that goes well wide. 14th career playoff goal for Burrows. His third goal of this series from Henrik and Daniel Sedin. Now Cole with it. Well, this is the second game in a row that Vancouver has scored first after the Sharks got the first goal in the first 3 games of this series.
Well, they control the tempo. Vancouver is a faster team overall. They played at a faster pace. And, of course, any team, when you score a goal, you're full of adrenaline and the pace goes even higher. That's why it's important for San Jose in this shift and any time Vancouver scores a goal to try and slow it down.
Turnover, White gets a shot away into the glove of Luongo, and he will hold it there. The Sedin twins working their magic, and Burrows able to finish it off.
Can I help you?
Are these tablets...
Mom, allow me. Are these tablets flash ready?
Yes.
Which ones?
These, including the Samsung Galaxy Tab.
What about movies?
Straight from Android Market to the Motorola Zoom.
4G upgradable.
4G LTE upgradable.
You always wear glasses?
Only when I'm not wearing contacts.
He's clean. My job's done.
A wide selection of tablets at great prices. From the people who know them best. Verizon.
Any minute.
Hey, you know they're not coming back.
Really? But they just bought me.
Get over it, Tubby. They're in Vegas. And they left us here to rot. Can't blame them. With all the 5-star restaurants, spas, designer golf courses, even pool parties.
Wait, I'm gonna rot?
On training days,
I need the fuel to get me ahead of the pack.
Start with a breakfast that can't be beat.
Like the protein-packed Sunrise Subway Melt. Try it with juicy tomatoes, fresh toasted on flatbread.
Trying to stay on track?
You've got to eat the best.
Like the Orchard Chicken Salad Sub. Taste terrific chicken with apples, tangy cranberries, and crunch-alicious celery on freshly baked bread.
Subway, the official training restaurant of Apollo Ono.
Blake Griffin.
Nasty Lukin.
And athletes everywhere.
gets the goal as Henrik and Daniel Sedin combined to set up a goal, the fourth consecutive goal in this series by Vancouver. The Twins have set up.
They are so good right now. They're so full of themselves. They're back to the Sedin Twins of the regular season. I mean, Henrik was marvelous, and Daniel Sedin ended up the top scorer in the entire National Hockey League.
And you go back to the Kessler 5-on-3 goal that Salo got an assist on. Henrik assisted on that, so Henrik's been in on the last five goals that the Canucks have scored in this series.
The Sharks defensively were in a good position. It looks like there's a high stick right off the faceoff there on Logan Couture.
How many times have we seen that in this series? That's what, at least the third time. The Thornton one that went undetected. The Setoguchi one, now Couture.
Now Bieksa drops it back. Hand Hughes will have to chase it. Gets to it, plays it hard up the boards. Higgins has it now. Bounces it in on Niemi. That was a dangerous bouncing puck that he had to be sure of. Now Douglas Murray. Couture right side, Thornton. Broken up by Hand Hughes. He dumps it back now into the San Jose zone. Approaching the halfway mark of the first period of game five. 1-0 Canucks. A win for Vancouver, and they advance to the Stanley Cup Final for the third time in franchise history, the first time since 1994.
We're looking over at the bench here. Big Joe came off. Bieksa got him with a pretty good hit near, right at the San Jose Sharks bench. Joe being so big, there was no impact on that upper body, that shoulder area.
Hanson plays it around the board to the San Jose zone. Whipped back to the net by Edler. Didn't miss by much on the short side. Huskins couldn't get it by the stick of Torres. Now Huskins takes a hit from LaPierre. Vlasic, stretch pass for Pavelski.
That was a nice play. Pavelski was on the fly. Vlasic had his head up the whole way. I don't think he could get the puck to sit flat. And it wasn't a good pass to Pavelski that he could control. But those are the types of things you have to try and stretch out that Vancouver D.
Turned over by the Canucks. Here's Wellwood trying to make a pay. Good recovery, though, by Edler. Wellwood still has it. Gets it to Heatley. Shot was blocked. Never got through.
Wellwood put that right on the tape. That was a great pass by Wellwood. After Ian White held the line and stripped it from Tanner Glass.
Now pushed along Wellwood again, trying to get it in front. Couldn't do it, still holds it. And then it hit the skate of Tanner Glass, the puck did. But the Sharks trying to stay on it. This third line trying to get something going for Tom McClellan. Sent to the side of the net here by Edler. Recovered by Torrey Mitchell. Spins off a check. Here's Heatley. Dropped it back for Ian White. White with a shot that goes wide. Wellwood reached out for it as Oreskovich will finally clear it.
That's probably one of the best shifts of the series for Kyle Wellwood.
That third line.
Yeah.
A lot of sustained pressure right there.
Now Tanev plays it around on the far side. Henrik Sedin hammers this. This is usually a set play trying to catch Daniel with a big rebound off the end boards, but this is going to be icing.
Well, the Vancouver Canucks are keeping a close eye on Joel Thornton, and so are we. Every time he goes out there, we want to see what he does. That's the one he had a scoring chance, but he's not holding on to the puck much, and he is definitely dodging people. He has an upper body issue. We don't know what it is. Bieksa got a piece of him there. You can see Joe lean with the shot. But the difference that I've seen in Joe Thornton so far in this game, up until this point, when Thornton gets the puck, he'll hold on, hold on, hold on, even in traffic. Not tonight. He can't afford to, and he's staying away from the boards.
He's taking all the faceoffs.
Yeah, he has. I was just gonna say that, Panger, and he lost that draw there, but Ballard steps up. Daniel Sedin plays it ahead. It's recovered by Douglas Murray, who angles it off the boards. The Canucks just making a change. So Bieksa let that puck go. Now Ballard. Daniel Sedin back to Bieksa. Lead pass for Burrows. Nearly got through there, but Huskins able to close it off, and now Jamal Mares. That hit the linesman. Second effort by Mares. He gets it deep in behind Luongo. And Hughes has it there. Knocked away. McGinn getting it on the forecheck. Desjardins takes a hit. Now the puck comes free. Desjardins scored his first career playoff goal in the Game 4 loss. Trying to make something happen here as he's pushed to the end boards by Ham Hughes. Up the near side, McGinn will get to it. Feeds it to the point. Quickly sent in wide of Luongo. Desjardins centering pass. A chance for Mares. And one of the Canucks made a terrific defensive play.
I think that was Bieksa at the last moment there. This fourth line doing a great job after the third line had done a real stellar job for San Jose.
And for one of the few times in this series, the Sharks get sustained pressure and then a line change to get fresh troops out on the ice.
That was Huskins that had that chance on the short side. The defenseman had moved well in on the cycle.
Well, he was able to do that because the San Jose Sharks forwards were making a line change, so he knew Ryan Cole was coming on the ice behind him. Huskins did the smart thing, so good strategy and good execution by the Sharks here in the last two or three shifts.
LaPierre with a big hit on Vlasic. Angled up the boards. Elaine Vigneault sensing that the last couple of shifts have gone in favor of San Jose, so he brings out LaPierre, Hanson, and Torres. Line that was really solid in the first two games of this series as this shot by Baleen does not get through. Here's Torres with it. Took a hit from Setoguchi as the puck goes back now into the Shark zone, recovered by Douglas Murray.
Well, San Jose's really got Vancouver standing around with their feet spread, not skating with the puck, constantly playing defense.
Baleen knocked it away from Hanson. Hanson recovers to roll it back behind the Emmy as we hit 6 minutes remaining here in the first period. Not many whistles, but we do get a whistle now, and it's going to be a hooking penalty. We'll get the call when we come back.
I'm Cheeseburger. This is Buffalo Chicken, and this is Sloppy Joe.
We're brothers.
We all taste great.
Some more than others.
Ah! Hot Pocket Side Shots. Three delicious flavors stuffed into soft baked buns.
Hot Pockets.
It's tough to run with congestion, so I'm taking charge with Claritin D. It relieves even my worst allergy symptoms. Nothing works stronger, faster, or longer for nasal congestion and sinus pressure without drowsiness. I only live Claritin Clear with Claritin D.
Hi, I'm Montel Williams from Money Mutual, your trusted source to over 60 lenders that can get you up to $1,000 in your checking account by tomorrow. These are tough times, and if you're facing an unexpected car repair bill, a medical emergency, or you just need extra cash to hold you over until payday, then you need to know about Money Mutual, an easy way to get short-term cash fast. So forget about bounced checks, overdraft charges, and late fees. Need cash tomorrow? Call 1-800-585-CASH today.
So at our company, we pay about the same, even though I'm a great driver and he's not so much.
Well, for a driver like you, I would recommend our new Snapshot discount. This little baby keeps track of your great driving habits so you can save money.
Amazing.
It's like an extra bonus savings.
He's my ride home.
How much can the Snapshot discount save you? Call or click today.
LA, for one of the few times in this series we've seen 5-on-5 play. Now you go on the penalty kill. What will be the key to this?
Well, obviously, the better we pressure up ice, the better we are on that penalty killing. And when they've had success, we've given them a pretty easy entry, so we'll try and do a better job tonight.
Your goalie looks pretty sharp.
We need him to play well. That's a real strong team out there, and they've got a lot of firepower, and we need him to be at his best.
Thanks, Coach.
My pleasure.
Well, you saw the penalty there on Henrik Sedin as the San Jose Sharks go a man up.
That was a one-handed reach.
Yeah, it was.
If you get up on the hands, I realize they call it pretty quickly, but wow.
Miller Lite power play for the San Jose Sharks, who so far in this series, 6-for-18. Nothing in the last game, though, when they had five consecutive. Boyle with a shot knocked down in front. Loose puck. And foot was tied up there by Bieksa. Now it comes to Boyle, right point. Hands it off for Marlowe. Marlowe shovels it to the front. Redirect and hit the post. Another chance. Stopped by Luongo.
Similar to the last opportunity for Thornton. Just the other side of it.
Another penalty coming. This is going to be a 5-on-3 opportunity. Unless the Sharks can score on the delay here. Here's Marlowe. Hands it off. Boyle couldn't one time it. Now he just gives it up to Burrows.
Yeah, they should have done that earlier. They wasted several seconds there. You're better off to have a 5-on-3, in my mind. Let Vancouver touch the puck earlier rather than pull the goaltender and go through that with more players on the ice. Look at the sequence here. Right through the crease area in that direction. Redirection. And then Thornton, you'll see the puck come right back through the crease. Thornton was on a horrible angle, and he just wanted to throw it right back through. The Corona Light goal cam shows you how close. And see, if Thornton had it been a right-hand shot, it might have been a better chance for him. He could have drawn it over and gotten a better chance.
No, that's just not a good call right there. And Kessler just comes out with a little, you know, a real three-quarter one stick-on-stick like that.
That used to be a good play. If you knocked the guy's stick out of his hands, it was like, shame on him, hold on tighter.
One timer was stopped by Luongo. Here's Pavelski with it.
That was a terrific save.
A 5-on-3. Now Marlowe to Thornton. Took the shot. It was blocked by Luongo.
We've seen if Luongo was going to cheat there.
Now Pavelski hands it off for Thornton. Thornton takes a look. Now it comes to Boyle. Fans on the one-timer. Good recovery by Thornton to get it back to Boyle. Marlowe hands it off. Pavelski with a chance. Save. Rebound take for Thornton. Oh, he can't get much out of it, but a great save. Centering pass for Heatley, and it's knocked off his stick and down the ice.
Just some brilliant work from Luongo there. Thornton with a couple of great chances. A bang-bang stop there. Thornton didn't get it elevated.
With 35 seconds remaining in the 5-on-3, Thornton takes a look, winds up, lets it go, save. Rebound! Bieksa is there, and he clears it off the boards to center ice.
What you like about Luongo right now is his battle. I mean, he's making saves that aren't orthodox, but he's doing whatever it takes to make that save.
Picked up by Pavelski, and tight, tries to go to the backhand. Luongo trying to cover it. Sent toward the net by Marlowe, but blocked and cleared by Bieksa. Down to the final 10 seconds of the Henrik Sedin penalty. That's the time remaining in the 5-on-3. Joe Thornton hands it off. Marlowe gets it to the front block. Burrell able to clear it.
Well, that's what you need when you're killing off two penalties simultaneously. You need brilliant goaltending, and you need timely execution on jumping players in front of the net. And Vancouver's done a terrific job of turning it over and getting it down.
Couture had his pocket picked by Yannick Hansen, who cut something on that shot, but he missed the net. And that allows the Sharks to come back the other way with some speed. Whoa, for White, hands it off, Setoguchi to the backhand. Off of his stick, recovered by Cole again. 10 seconds left now in the Kessler penalty. White keeps it up, and that's deflected to the near corner.
Good play by Raymond, though, to get out to that right point as quickly as he could. It forced White to fire it off the mark.
Kessler out of the box. Ian White's shot is blocked to the corner. Cole sends it far side, just off the stick of Vlasic. He gets it to the front. Good job by Kessler, though, on Logan Couture.
What a pass by Cole. Vlasic should have handled that one better. That was a terrific scoring chance.
Loose in front of Luongo, but before Cole can get there, it's scooped up by Mason Raymond. Raymond loses his balance. Now it's taken by Cole. Centering attempt, hit a skate. Now Couture with it. Out to the line, Vlasic slides it across to Ian White. Hammers the puck wide on the glove side. Shots are 14-5 San Jose. They've had the pressure on Roberto Luongo. Now it comes back to Ian White. Slides it across, but Pavelski was moving the other way, and now it's cleared all the way down. Going to be icing here on the Canucks.
And that's one tired Vancouver Canuck group on the ice. The D that jumped out of the ice are going to have to go back out because of the icing. And you look at Roberto Luongo here. I talked about battle, but there's a lot of side-to-side movement. The Sharks are putting everything in that. That's the two-pad slide save that I'm talking about here. It goes off his left pad. And then it goes off his left pad again as he tries to slide that right pad underneath for the two-pad slide. Thornton, not hesitant to shoot the puck whatsoever, firing the puck. Some of those little passes, though, Brian, that Joe normally makes from the corner, much like the Sedins make, didn't get through.
Yeah, and it looks like Vancouver's called a timeout. That's good timing. They have to take it in this first period, but they just had too many tired players out there after being under siege. Joe Thornton should know better, though, than he should have gone in the upper reaches of the net. I know it was a great save by Luongo. Thornton not showing any ill effects when it comes to shooting the puck. He has pulled the trigger there, and he was brilliant. There's that left hand again, that little wiggle of the fingers there that we saw during the warm-ups that we showed you in the open of the show tonight. But Thornton has moved the puck well. I think San Jose has to control their anxiety level here. They did everything but score on that power play. Take that positive energy, keep moving the puck around, and see if it goes in later.
Amazing that Vancouver on their 5-on-3 scored three of them in a minute and 55.
Yeah.
And the Sharks couldn't capitalize on that.
That was the first time in Stanley Cup playoff history that a team scored 3 5-on-3 goals in a game, let alone in a period, as Luongo able to stop that one. The only goal, Alex Burrows. It's 1-0 Canucks here in Game 5.
Is the newest.
Even newer. Oh.
Everything else is obsolete.
I just bought this one.
Oh, whoa, wait. Oh, 4D TV? Stupid.
You got the wrong TV, silly head.
The new buyback program. You buy it now, we buy it back when the new thing comes out.
Rough, dry skin taking over? There's an easy way to fix that. New Lubriderm Men's 3-in-1. The first and only body, face, post-shave lotion in one bottle.
Do something different?
New Lubriderm Men's 3-in-1.
I am ready for pizza and the game. Woo! Let's do this.
What's with the milk?
DiGiorno comes with Toll House cookies now.
We got milk!
Awesome!
New DiGiorno pizza and Nestle Toll House cookies. It's not delivery, it's DiGiorno pizza and cookies.
Well, the Vancouver Canucks have done a terrific job here at the beginning of the game, scoring a goal and going up 1-0. That was the goal by Alex Burrows and great work by the Sedins. And then Roberto Luongo takes over and does a fabulous job here when they were down to three men in the penalty-killing situation of a 5-on-3 against. He did get some terrific support and help, timely help in front of the net. You can see the way the goals have been scored in this series, even strength 5-on-4 and 5-on-3.
Well, the Canucks have been effective, I guess you could say, in all of those areas. And of course, their special teams during the regular season. Number one on the power play for Vancouver, tied for second on the penalty kill. Shots are now 15-5 in favor of San Jose as this draw controlled by the Canucks. The exit got it to center right, picked up by Daniel Sedin. Leaves it for Burrows. Now Henrik has it. Martin being strong on his stick.
Good face-off win by Burrows in his own zone.
Now Hughes sends it to Burrows. Reflects off the stick of Henrik Sedin as the two captains, Henrik Sedin and Thornton, out against each other. And Sedin drops it back. Now Hughes for Burrows. Deflects it in wide of Niemi. As Murray takes a look, lost the puck. Torres sends it out, high slot, Ballard with it. Turns and drives it back in deep. Big hit coming there. Rafi Torres at Douglas Murray. After the big hit that Torres threw on Douglas Murray at the end of the first period of game four that drew a penalty. Now Murray able to get back with a hit on LaPierre. Now Mitchell for Wellwood. He starts it back the other way. Mitchell had it knocked off his stick, and the puck is picked up here by Oreskovich. Up the left wing side, mishandles a bit. Recovers, and his pass broken up by Corey Mitchell. Held in by Daniel Sedin. Sends it to the front. Skips off the glove of Niemi. Heatley takes a big hit from Oreskovich. Less than a minute remaining of the period. Vlasic drives it along the boards behind Luongo. Salo. Bouncing puck. Now Pavelski has it knocked away. Burrows, who has the only goal so far here in game five, but now it's taken back by the Sharks. Klo battling there with Edler. Might be able to hear the voice of Stephen Walken saying, move that puck right now. And the players oblige. And Burrows drops it back. Henrik Sedin trying to buy some time for Daniel. Hands it off for a quick shot. Niemi to save. Doesn't control the rebound. Now he pokes it to the far boards. Henrik gets to it. Gets it to Daniel again. Bieksa tries a quick one-timer that hits off the side of the net. It'll be recovered by Huskins. He'll play it softly up the glass in the final 10 seconds of this first period. And the play whistled offside.
When Douglas Murray plays, he dishes out a lot of punishment, but on his last shift, he just misplays that puck. He gets taken down. The puck will come back around again. He'll go around one more time, and boom! Look at the impact there. Guess who? Rafi Torres. Rafi Torres has made a gigantic impact time and time again in these playoffs. This time, Murray was the recipient, not the disher.
And Murray had one hand on the puck as well with his stick. Yep. Touched the puck, and at that moment, Torres absolutely drills him.
Another offside called here. The Pizza Hut intermission report is coming up. Liam McHugh, Keith Jones, and Mike Milbury as the Sedin twins continue to make their magic. And Roberto Luongo, they call him Bobby Lou, will be on a goaltending clinic here in the first period. As the first period comes to an end, and there's your goal scorer, Burrow's third goal of the series and seventh of the playoffs. 1-0 Vancouver trying to move on to the Stanley Cup final for the first time in 17 years. The Pizza Hut intermission report is straight ahead. Basketball City of Vancouver, British Columbia. Game 5 of the Western Conference Finals. The Canucks lead the series 3-1, and they lead this Game 5 1-0 on a first period goal by Alex Burrows. Dave Strader along with Brian Engblom of the broadcast booth here at Rogers Arena. Our man inside the glass at ice level is Darren Pang. And we are ready for the start of period number 2. 15-6. The shot advantage in that first period favoring the Sharks when they got 6 on the power play, including 4 during a 5-on-3 when Roberto Luongo is at his best as Luongo steers this puck to the near side. And it's cleared by the Canucks all the way back out to center ice.
That's a good dump in right there by Setoguchi, putting it on the net, knowing that it's going to go over to the far corner and then get the forecheck. But Vancouver does an excellent job of getting it out of their zone.
Flow chips it ahead. It's blocked by Edler. Got it to center ice. Henrik Sedin has it there. Carries across the line. Knocked off his stick by Setoguchi, but recovered and sent back in deep by Burrows. Now Henrik Sedin. Huskins checks him and Vlasic. Able to get to this loose puck, but circles back. Sharks looking to complete a line change here. Thornton, Marlowe, and Couture coming out. Now McClellan sticking with the line changes he made to start this game 5 as Couture up the far side. Hamhuis trying to keep him to the outside. Centering pass. That was deflected in on Luongo when he had to make a save.
That was a set play coming through the neutral zone because Joe Thornton got the puck and he didn't even look. He just spun around and fired it to the far side to Couture coming late through the neutral zone. It was almost intercepted.
Yep.
A decent read there by Vancouver. A little bit of luck for Thornton in San Jose. You can't make those no-look plays. You got some smart players out there for Vancouver reading that situation.
Higgins had it knocked off his stick, but he recovered. Carries back in onside. 3 points that Higgins has in this series all came in the same game back in game 2. When the Canucks went for 7 goals to take a 2-0 lead in the series.
Vancouver making a change on the fly. Get the young defenseman Tanev on the ice going up against the Thornton line.
Loose puck out in front. Recovered here out to Tanev. Tanev's shot though deflected before it got in on Niemi. Now Thornton gets to it. Up to the line, Tanev. Didn't have a shooting lane, just played it diagonally. Now hammered by Boyle. Hits the skate to one of the Canucks, and here is Ballard with a chance and a save by Niemi. He'll hold it there.
Well, Joe Thornton played over 7 minutes in the first period. They didn't spare any horses on him, and he got 2 minutes on the power play. Look at some of the scoring chances he had. That one jammed him a little bit, but it was a great scoring chance. That one was the one I thought he should have gotten elevated. Then on the other side, he had half the net, but a really bad angle. This one he hammers with the screen in front, but I think he was actually limited a little bit by the screen of Pavelski. But Joe Thornton, we know he's banged up, but he was in the middle of everything. 4 shots on net, some great chances, no goals.
And he also gives his teammates confidence knowing that he's good by establishing that shot first presence. You know, that'll buy some time for him later on in the game.
And this play is offside. Gives us a chance to go inside the glass presented by BlackBerry with Darren Pang.
Thanks, Dave. Talking to Trent Yanni, the assistant coach of the San Jose Sharks after the first, he talked an awful lot about the fourth line energy that they got in that first period, the third line energy. They had some sustained pressure on that one shift. They got a line change. They had a little bit more flow. Now, obviously, less special teams, only, you know, the 5-on-3, more 5-on-5, but they like their jump. They like their attack time.
Yeah, this is the third line out there now. They've changed things around. They front-end loaded their top 2 lines. I think that's good, especially for Pavelski, and it puts Couture with Thornton too for a little bit of support. It doesn't look like he needs it right now, but I think that the team needs this, and then it's a case of the third and fourth lines. Hey, you guys, get out there, generate some enthusiasm and sustained attack.
Here's LaPierre swept in toward Niemi. And Panger, you mentioned the defense tandem of Tanev and Ballard, and they just played another strong shift. And their coach Alain Vigneault was complimentary of the 9 or 10 minutes that those two guys gave him stepping into this series. As Desjardins on the angle, that was blocked.
When Rick Bonus runs the D for the Vancouver Canucks, he did an excellent job. He knew that the Thornton line was out for a long time, hemmed in their own zone. So at that end, he got a good change. And both Tanev and Ballard both got shots on goal on that last sequence they had.
Hansen lost his stick, tried to glove the puck out of the zone, then he lost his glove. And he's going to try to get to the bench and get a new twig, which he does. That was going to make the change, I guess.
That wasn't a heads-up play by Vlasic. Should have got it to the other side.
Vlasic shot is blocked, and Desjardins just couldn't reach the rebound as Luongo looks to his right and has something to say to the referee, Kazari, as the play moved up the ice.
If you see a stick on the ice, you have to figure out who doesn't have one. It was Hansen who didn't have one. If Vlasic had got it back to their left wing side, they had a chance to move it around. Hansen ended up going all the way to his bench.
Absolutely.
Which was a long way to get a new twig.
He left his zone, got a new stick, went back. It's 5-on-4 for 15 seconds.
Now Ballard, the crowd reacting to the referee taking a spill.
Oh boy. That's Steve Kazari. He went down hard.
Now Bieksa. Cody Hodgson plays it ahead. Stepping up was Murray, but he wasn't able to make the play that he was hoping to. Now the Canucks have to go back and tag up with the delayed offside indicated. Up the right wing side for Setoguchi. Stripped away by Burrows, who still has the only goal in this game, 5. Jose Sharks trying to avoid elimination and force a game 6. Back at HP Pavilion. Taken by White. Right over the glove, right over the head of Luongo.
It went off the knee of Bieksa. He went down to block it.
Now Burrows across the line, drops it back to Sedin for Henrik. A shot just wide of Niemi.
It is sick watching them play, isn't it? In a complimentary way. Holy jumping.
That was a really poor line change by San Jose, though. A 3-on-2. Look at the congestion up at the San Jose bench. And then you got the 3-on-2. Excellent puck work here. They move it into the middle of the ice and just miss it by a hair. Burrows gets it, throws it back. That's Daniel to Henrik. Henrik moves in. Well executed. He just missed the net.
And if Burrows goes harder to the net, he's got a tap in right there.
And you know what? Come to think of it, when I saw that the second time, Panger, that's what Henrik was thinking. I think that was a pass and not a shot.
Yeah,
and
no
Burrows,
question.
Burrows didn't go hard enough to the net.
But the one he slipped through the legs of Miami in game 4, that was a pass, right?
He looked at after the game. He didn't say, I'm not telling, but then he said it was a pass.
Good answer. Thornton has it slide off his stick. He chops at it. Now waving at it was Marlowe, but it's cleared back into the San Jose zone. We played just over 5 minutes here in the second period. Now Couture gets it ahead and picked up now by Vlasic, who drops it back now. Huskins back to Vlasic as the Sharks regroup. Panger down at ice level facing elimination. Your thoughts on the Sharks and their composure so far in this game trailing?
I think technically, tactically, as Todd McClellan told us before the game, I think they've been rock solid. I think they're composed on the bench, not overreacting. They're communicating, letting guys know if someone's on them or if they're going to get drilled.
Here is White with a shot that was blocked by Kessler, picked up by Wellwood. Wellwood, Heatley, and Thornton, the combination here for Todd McClellan. Thornton makes an empty move, slides it to the crease, but it's covered up here by Luongo. First period goal by Burrows. All the scoring in this game, 5, 1-0 Canucks.
Offering large three-topping pizzas for $7.99 each Monday through Wednesday carryout.
$7.99? That's crazy.
I'm not crazy.
This pizza is worth at least twice what we're charging for.
The economy is still tough, and this is a great way to give customers value.
Just because I'm a car guy doesn't mean I don't care about the environment.
I also care about doing things right.
And what I'm leaving behind for the next car guy.
Introducing Valvoline Next Gen. Backed by the Valvoline Engine Guarantee Program, it's 50% recycled oil, 100% Valvoline protection.
Consumer credit card to get 5% off every day. Or choose special financing on purchases of $299 or more. Experience. Lowe's. Let's build something together.
Sedin Twins have set up the only goal of this game back in the first period. Time now for the right way to play, brought to you by Valvoline Next Gen.
Yeah, this is the right way to play. 22 and 33 have got that thing going for them again. They've had the puck an awful lot in this game. They've generated passes. They love those 6, 7, 8 foot passes. That was a pass there at the end that Burrows didn't quite get to the net with, but he did get to the opening there, and that was the only goal in this game. Went from Daniel to Henrik, Henrik to Burrows, and the only goal, 1-0 Vancouver.
Now that's the right way to play. Sharks control. White gets it across, fanning up a one-timer with Wellwood. That puck was elevated. Now here's Vallin as that goes onto the netting and out of play. Well, we mentioned that the Sedin brothers have assisted on each of the last four goals in this series, but how about what they did with 3-plus points in the same playoff game, joining this group? Don and Nick Metz, Toronto back in 42, the Richards for Montreal in 56, the Stastnys back in 81 with Quebec, the Sutters for the Islanders back in 83, and then Henrik and Daniel combining for 7 points.
All that 5-on-3 time, boy, you can't give those guys that much time on 5-on-3s and not pay for it.
You would have played against the Stastnys, and there were three of them for a period of time in Quebec. They did things a little differently. More power players?
Yeah, they were more power players, and it seemed like there were seven of them out there.
Good point. But Peter, he was as strong as an ox, wasn't he?
Whoa, what a step-up play by Ballard.
Yeah, big and strong, and then McGinn goes for a big hit. As physical play picks up here on this shift. In the second period, Desjardins plays it up the far side. Jamal Mares was tied up by Ballard. Remember, it was Ballard had that big hip check that sent Jamie McGinn flying. Here's Oreskovich after a steal. A shot hit the goalpost. Niemi wasn't sure where that puck was.
Tanner Glass turned the puck over in the neutral zone, running at Douglas Murray. He got the worst of it, but he did turn it over, leading to that chance.
Quick centering pass for Kessler off his stick. A little bit too much on that pass to handle. And now McGinn will send it in deep as that line will change it up. Bieksa flying to the neutral zone, looking for the return pass that couldn't get through.
Oh, the linesman got in the way of Kloder. He couldn't stick handle through his legs.
Classic tying up Higgins. Huskins will get to this loose puck. Off the glove of Bieksa, knows he's going to take a hit there from Kloder.
You know it's easier said than done, but you know that the Sharks are trying to get a five-man unit of Douglas Murray and Boyle on the ice. With Thornton, that last shift there, the fourth line was there with Boyle, and they couldn't get anything going from their own zone, as we talked about with that turnover.
Close set of Gucci and Pavelski trying to get something going in the offensive zone here for the Sharks. We trail 3-1 in the series and 1-0 in this game five. Huskins jumped into the play, and Close had that pass go behind him. And Pavelski plays it ahead. Nice lead pass here for Klo to the forehand, but couldn't get the shot away. Angled back for Vlasic. He sends it toward the Vancouver goal, and that went off the stick of Hamhuis and just wide. And Hamhuis checked on the play. Couture for Klo.
Those are scoring chances, though, that Klo has to come away with something on net. That was an excellent chance for him right down the throat, and he never really got a good shot on net.
White could not hold this puck in. It's offside.
When you play against a big guy like Douglas Murray, a lot of times you'll shy away. Well, that's glass not shying away. Broken glass on the ice, that is. And it leads to Oreskovich with a terrific chance on the short side, and he wings it off the post.
And here's that play here with glass turning it over in the neutral zone. There's Ballard stepping up right there, catching Desjardins with his head down. Desjardins is just a great story, as we mentioned. Central Hockey League, East Coast Hockey League, American Hockey League, and now in the Western Conference Finals.
Usually when you have a guy as big as Douglas Murray, teams will shy away from guys like that. It just takes so much energy to hit the guy.
Yeah.
But Vancouver has not done that. He's like a Humvee out there, but he's gotten whacked a lot in this series.
Couture with a shot up high on Luongo, who drops down and has it in the glove, and he'll hold it there with 11:06 remaining in the second period. And, you know, we made a lot about the few number of shots Vancouver had, 13 in that game four win. They only have 7, and we're approaching the halfway mark of this
game five.
Yeah.
Todd McClellan and coaching staff reinforced with the team. Yeah, we lost last game. Yeah, we had a bad stretch. And yeah, we gave up 5-on-3 goals. But we did a lot of good stuff. Yeah, they only had 13 shots on us, guys. So they've continued that part of it, certainly. And they've been terrific offensively in this game.
Kessler tossed out of there. Higgins will step in now for the Canucks across from Patrick Marleau. Good second effort by Higgins to recover that faceoff. The extra flips it ahead now. Mason Raymond laid it over the glove of White. Higgins is going to catch up to this puck. Marleau gives him a shove, knocks him off balance. And behind the play, we get a high sticking call from Stephen Walkham. The Stanley Cup Conference Finals presented by Progressive continue on versus tomorrow at 7:30 Eastern when the series shifts back to Tampa Bay for Game 6 between the Bruins and the Lightning. And if the Sharks are able to win this game here tonight, they would host Game 6 Thursday night at 8:30 Eastern. History will be made on versus.
And VX is going off for a high sticking minor penalty as he clipped Logan Couture. Couture's been clipped a couple of times in this game. This one got called on Bieksa.
Power play number 3. And another Miller Lite power play here for the San Jose Sharks. Their third of the game. Remember, they had 5 consecutive power plays to start game 4. Couldn't convert. And certainly came back to Burnham as the shorthanded Canucks able to drive this puck all the way down the ice.
Well, Vancouver coaching staff says that San Jose has the best entries on the power play into the zone of anybody in the National Hockey League. That's really saying something. That wasn't a very good one right there.
What a set of Gucci thinking.
I know. I mean, it's like he fanned on the dump in there and shot it right to the defenseman. I think that was Stallow. But the Vancouver did a fabulous job. And again, turning the puck over just like they did in game 4. San Jose has to get better on their entries.
Well, I think their entries were fine as Kessler's literally hurt. He's, I don't know if it's a, is it an equipment or is it a...
Not sure.
Left leg problem.
He's hurt.
Boyle with a shot. He scores! At the last second, Luongo loses sight of this puck. And on the power play, the San Jose Sharks have tied this game 5.
Boy, a lot happening on this power play. San Jose couldn't get it in. I'm not sure if it was hit by Thornton in front of the net, but it was shot from the point. But there's Ryan Kessler. He is in big trouble. He was on the attack, on the offense, trying to chase down Dan Boyle. Let's see what happens here. And just like he pulls up lane, all of a sudden he pulls up lane.
Yeah.
He wasn't hit. He limped all the way to the bench. Obviously not a good sign. Then here we go through. The shot from the point, deflected off. I think, is that Marleau?
No, it's Ballard.
Through?
It went off Ballard's glove.
Ballard's glove.
Ryan. You can see it from my angle, right off the glove
there. Oh, yeah.
And then past the glove side. This one's going from our Miller Lite goal cam. You see Luongo's taking it in the midsection. He's got his left arm collapsed to his body, anticipating he's just going to block it. And then it gets taken over there.
I wondered if Marlowe's stick had tweaked it also as he went by.
Yeah, he did take a wave at it, Brian. We'll wait for the official call, but either way, it's on the power play, and the San Jose Sharks have tied this game, and we'll keep an eye, of course, to see when Ryan Kessler returns.
And the Corona light goal cam really, really showed the way. You can see the goalie's reaction right away. You know, you see that he's trying to tighten everything up, taking the one area, then looks quickly to the left, and then he looks straight ahead like, whoa, what happened there?
They're announcing it as Marleau's goal.
Now, they'd be wrong on that.
Yeah. We'll take another look at it. Certainly Marleau would be the one that would know whether or not he touched that puck. And we got another penalty away from the play here.
Dan Sedin went down hard. Corey Mitchell is going to go off for the minor.
Power play goal celebrated by San Jose as they've tied this game 5-1-1.
What can you tell me about Shell nitrogen-enriched gasoline?
They clean up gunk left by lower-quality gasoline.
Then they act as a protective barrier that shields and protects engines against performance-robbing gunk.
You really are experts.
Hi, I'm Cheeseburger. This is Buffalo Chicken, and this is Sloppy Joe.
We're brothers.
We all taste great.
Some more than others.
Ah! Hot Pocket Side Shots. 3 delicious flavors stuffed into soft-baked buns.
Hot Pockets.
This one works.
The price sure doesn't.
I'm tired of shopping around.
Too bad you're not buying car insurance.
Like, that's easy.
Oh, it is. Progressive Direct showed me their rates and the rates of their competitors. I saved hundreds when switching.
You could use hundreds.
Yeah.
Wake up and smell the savings.
Out there with a better way. Now that's Progressive.
Hi, I'm Montel Williams from Money Mutual, your trusted source to over 60 lenders that can get you up to $1,000 in your checking account by tomorrow. These are tough times, and if you're facing an unexpected car repair bill, a medical emergency, or you just need extra cash to hold you over until payday, then you need to know about Money Mutual, an easy way to get short-term cash fast. So forget about bounced checks, overdraft charges, and late fees. Need cash tomorrow? Call 1-800-585-CASH today.
Talk about the special teams now. You're going to go on the penalty kill. What will be the key here?
Well, a very good power play. We've seen it throughout the series, so we're going to have to be sharp. Any type of face-offs or clearing attempts that we get, we're going to have to make sure they're 200 feet.
Thanks, Todd. Thank you.
And there you can see the penalty against Torrey Mitchell. So he goes to the box to give the Vancouver Canucks their first power play opportunity of this Game 5. The power play brought to you by Craftsman. And you heard Tom McClellan tell Darren Pang that they have to be on top of their penalty kill here against this potent Vancouver power play that has scored 9 times in this series. And it starts with a face-off win for the Canucks. Henrik Sedin hands it off. Out to Edler. Daniel with a drive. Niemi the save, and he holds it there with Burrows waving the stick in front of him.
Let's go back to prior to the power play goal that we just saw. Mason Raymond is the guy who should have got the high sticking call. They got the wrong guy. They got Kevin Bieksa, who was a good penalty killer for him. And then Ballard is out there killing the penalty. It goes off of his glove and into the net. I don't think Patrick Marleau touched that one.
No, they announced it as Marleau's fifth of the series for Boyle and Pavelski, and I would expect that that will get changed. Edler with a good keep in here now for the Canucks on the power play. Pass the stick of Daniel Sedin, picked up by Salo. Now Salo drops it back, gets the return from Burrows. Game tied at 1 on a power play goal by the Sharks. Trying to stay alive in this Western Conference final. Edler shot, Niemi the save, and importantly, no rebound.
Niemi's got to have his best game of the series. There's no doubt. Panger, you talked about his save percentages throughout these playoffs. And going back to last year, we've mentioned many times when he won the Stanley Cup with the Chicago Blackhawks, he had some poor or mediocre games, and then he bounced back with great ones, and he went all the way to the Stanley Cup. He didn't look too much at a save percentage or whatever. But after just kind of a so-so game last game, he's got to be stellar in this one.
Just 30 seconds into this power play opportunity. Henrik Sedin, strong faceoff win, gets it back now from Edler. Daniel Sedin out to Edler, far side, one timer on the way from Salo.
I think that might have hit the right elbow of Burrows in front of the net.
Now Douglas Murray is going to push it ahead. Heatley.
Burrows going to the box. He's hurting all right.
Luongo with the save. And Edler hands it off now. Henrik Sedin across the line. Pulls up, down to that. Edler with a drive. Miami the save. And he'll hold it there. We're down to 57 seconds remaining in this Vancouver power play.
Vancouver's power play has been brilliant in this series. 9 goals already so far. Not able to get their shots all the way through to the net. And one of the most piercing and damaging ones was that big one-timer that ended up hurting Burrows. He went right to the bench.
So they're already without Kessler. He has not returned as of yet with that lower body injury. And now this wicked slap shot by Salo right off the right side of the body there of Burrows, who's in good position. It's almost too good of a screen. Doesn't get out of the way, leave any opening whatsoever.
Pavelski for the Sharks. Got the puck to the corner. White hammers it. Bieksa fell down. Oh, does a good job keeping it in. Sends it to the corner. Higgins buying some time. Sends it out now to Hamhuis. Hamhuis gets it to the front, redirected, but knocked away by Ian White and cleared out the center ice.
The efficiency level of the Sharks so much higher in this game at all their levels. Way better than they were in Game 4. Look a lot more like Game 3.
Raymond angles it off the boards. Here's Bieksa. Sends it back down to Raymond. Winds up, lets it go. Good shot block there. There were a couple of shots. I believe it was Couture.
Well, I think San Jose doing a nice job here blocking shots and make sure the alleyways are taken care of. The Vancouver defense have 15 points in this series, 9 of them on the power play.
LaPierre with it now. Final seconds ticking off on the Torrey Mitchell minor. Mitchell steps out on the ice. The Canucks still have it deep in the San Jose zone. Now it skips away from Rafi Torres. Four shots for the Canucks on that power play as they try to get another one in on Niemi. But it's turned aside and sent back out to center ice.
You know, the one thing that Vancouver couldn't do then, and I know I'm looking at the 5-on-3s that they scored, but they're trying to lure Niemi outside the post in the white paint because he will challenge on the short side, get him overcommitted, and then play it to the middle of the ice or the far side because it's a long push. He does tend to overcommit on those plays, but they weren't able to do that on this power play.
Back the other way now. Henrik Sedin for Burrows, far side, jumping up. Daniel gets it to the front, and Ballard trying to get a stick on it.
When he went to shoot, his stick ended up hitting the leg of Dan Boyle. Boyle was well positioned, but I think that was a bit lucky there, too. Nice setup in front of the net.
Jay Scherers, the linesman, started to put his whistle up to his mouth to call too many men on the ice, and Stephen Walkham beat him to it. So the San Jose Sharks are going to go on the power play for the fourth time in this game.
Well, it's all about momentum swings. You can see Burrows is back on the ice after being hit by that shot. They move the puck around nicely, get it to the front. Watch Ballard. Ballard gets a little bit of a sort of a chunky shot at it, but on his follow-through, his stick hit the leg of Boyle, so he came away with nothing. Too many men on the ice for the Vancouver Canucks. After killing off a penalty there, San Jose with a chance to build on something here. San Jose's had more puck possession and are sharper offensively a little bit than Vancouver.
And the San Jose power play is brought to you by Craftsman. Just to take the lead.
Kessler has returned to the Vancouver bench, fellas.
All right. Wilwood hands it off down the quick centering pass. Deflects out to Boyle. Now on the far side, Wilwood again. Pavelski set up in the middle of that penalty-killing box. Now Thornton able to get it to Marlowe. Marlowe hands it off, Boyle. Hammers this puck right pad, saved by Luongo. Comes all the way out to the left point. Thornton has it there. Now to Wellwood. Doesn't see anything there. Wheels back out. Now hands it off in the corner, Marlowe. Sends it out to Boyle. Boyle takes it wide on LaPierre. Hands it off to Thornton in the corner with some room. Gets a shot away, save, rebound, chance for Pavelski. No, he couldn't settle the puck down. Wanted to quickly get that back in Luongo. Wellwood, and that tips over the stick of Boyle.
This is the best game I've seen Kyle Wellwood play in this series, and he's getting rewarded with some power play time there. Setoguchi has been out there in the past with Thornton and Marlowe in that first power play unit, and Setoguchi hasn't been able to get anything going at all, so Wellwood getting some ice time there.
Great job by Boyle to race off the ice before Vlasic can play that puck on the change.
Now Paul kind of telegraphed that. Mason Raymond knocked it away. Raymond with speed to the outside on Ian White. Clough comes back to collect it now with 4:45 remaining here in the second period of this Game 5 of the Western Conference Final. Again, the Canucks leading 3-1 with a win, would advance to the Stanley Cup Final and await the outcome of that Boston-Tampa Bay Eastern Conference Final Series. A win here by the Sharks forces a Game 6 on Thursday night back at HP Pavilion.
Boy, what a clinic Vancouver is putting on here on this penalty kill. San Jose's got nothing going, all because Vancouver extremely efficient here.
I can hear Rick Bowness from the Vancouver bench, so really harping on it too with the players. Stay tight. Stay as a five-man unit. Give them the outside. There is nothing on the interior on that power play.
Here's a chance for Heatley to brace him up the outside of the net after Luongo just kind of froze and held his position. Comes to Heatley again.
Heatley's got to work hard at getting scoring chances, getting in the open, moving around.
I like Torrey Mitchell at center ice in this series right now. That's the first time we've seen him extended time at center ice.
Nice job here. Here's McGinn, centers in, and it's off the stick of Setoguchi and just wide.
9 power play shots for the Sharks in this game, and still just 11 total for Vancouver. Setoguchi kind of lost the edge on escape and battles to keep the puck in the Vancouver zone. Big hit by McGinn. Ballard trying to draw the penalty. Nothing coming. Stephen Walken looks right at it. Sent back in on Luongo.
I think there was a little embellishment there on Ballard's part, and that's why the referee didn't bite on it.
And Walken having something to say to Daniel Sedin right now. There's the hit. It is 1-1 late in the second.
The newest,
even newer.
Everything else is obsolete.
I just bought this one.
What the?
Baby.
Oh, whoa, wait. Oh, 4D TV? Stupid.
You got the wrong TV, silly head.
The new buyback program. You buy it now, we buy it back when the new thing comes out.
Real meats and fresh cut veggies. That's what makes Papa John's specialty pizzas special.
And now try Papa John's newest specialty, our sausage sensation pizza with 3 kinds of sausage and fresh sliced peppers and onions.
Nobody does what Papa John's does.
For a limited time, get the new sausage sensation or the Tuscan 6 cheese pizza. Your choice, just $11 each for a large. Order at the new papajohns.com.
Everything's better when Papa's in the house. Better ingredients, better pizza, Papa John's.
Time to take matters into your own hands, especially when a little work can mean big savings. AutoZone's got the advice and expertise you need to take on any job and get it done right. Because do it yourself doesn't mean you have to do it alone. Get in the zone. AutoZone.
Good news for Vancouver fans. That's Ryan Kessler. Watch this when he pulled up lame and that left leg just went on him. He wasn't hit or anything. He limped his way to the bench, spent the last several minutes until this last commercial break came out and he was testing that leg. Just kind of stretching a little bit, gingerly skating around, and there he is to take the faceoff.
Kessler had it stripped away, but following up is Bieksa to dump it deep behind Niemi. Big hit by Higgins on Boyle, and this is going to be icing against the San Jose Sharks.
Here's another look at Kessler coming out and stretching around. They're just testing that leg out to see how it feels. Pretty gingerly there, but the fact that he was out there on that last shift to take the face off, and we'll see how much he plays from here on in, though. Such a valuable guy.
Vancouver with an edge in the faceoff circle so far in this game. Having won 18 of 31, just under 60% efficiency.
2 games in a row, the shots heavily in favor of the San Jose Sharks.
Absolutely.
25 to 11. They only gave up 13 in the last game.
Now Thornton jams it up the near boards. It's picked up by Couture. Makes a hit there from Daniel Sedin. Now Boyle comes back to help out. Boyle fanned on that pass attempt. Burroughs gets in on him. Short side attempt there that Niemi blocked.
Tried to bank it off his leg, didn't he?
Yep. Daniel Sedin always heads up. Didn't see a play in the middle of the ice. Just threw it at the net.
And again, the puck doesn't come out against the Sedins. Here's Hedrick with a chance. Saved by Niemi. And the rebound just wide off the stick of Burroughs.
Oh, the Sharks are playing with fire. Popping the puck over time and time again.
Here is Edler. Wanted to get it into Hedrick. Couture. Anticipating that with Burroughs, sends it out. Here's Daniel Sedin. Sends it across now. Hitter quick. Centering pass the other way. Goes to the board. Daniel with a shot blocked by Murray.
They got so many tired guys out there. Dan Boyle can hardly move.
Good play by Edler just to fire it in the far side into an open area.
Set down the ice by Thornton, but wide of the net. And that is going to be an icing call.
I think they're going to have to take their time out here. I wouldn't be surprised if San Jose takes it. Dan Boyle cannot even move. Along the wall, turnovers and terrific forechecking there by Vancouver.
Todd McCullough's waiting for as long as he can.
Yep,
he good communication with Steve Kozari.
Yep.
Telling him to just watch my eyes. He's bought it as much time as he could to get as much time for his players.
A Corona Light goal cam shows you just how close that puck was to scooting underneath of Antti Niemi. Good screen again by Burrows, who's actually in the paint again, and he jams it right up the end of the foot, and you can see it disappear and reappear. Looks like it hit the back of Niemi and goes out. But Henrik Sedin has been brilliant, creating so much, taking the shots when they're there. Well, it hit the side of his thigh and goes off to the side.
So Burrows in the first period for Vancouver from Henrik and Daniel Sedin, and the Sharks who have used their timeouts. So both teams have used their timeouts now strategically on icing calls, but that's something to remember if this stays a tight game and we get down to the late stages of the third period. And for now, the San Jose goal credited to Marlowe from Boyle and Pavelski, but that could change.
Yeah, that's where that call on an icing play where you can't make any line changes if you ice the puck. That has changed the game so dramatically and forced coaches to take timeouts in first period, second period, whenever. His defense were exhausted. McClellan had to take it.
Out to hand, who fakes. Now he lets it go. And it went wide of Niemi. Bieksa moves up the board.
Good pinch by Bieksa. Good read right there.
Now hand, who gets to it on the far side. Thornton takes a quick look. Oh. Turnover. Higgins backhands it wide. Now Thornton lifts it high in the air. Marlowe gets a stick on it.
Looking for some backspin.
Yeah. Looks like one of your 60-degree wedges there, Panger.
Yeah.
With an old Pallada ball. Now Ian White again, pressured by Nason Raymond. Here comes Higgins in with a hit. Set a good cheek. Hammers this puck off the boards. Nobody could see it for a moment. And that's going to roll far enough for icing. Boy, Ryan Clough thought he might have a chance to get to a loose puck. Let's remind you that the Verizon Intermission Report with Liam Keith and Mike coming up. And can Ryan Kessler be effective after the injury? Is he 100%? And the Bruins one win away from the Stanley Cup Finals despite their power play not connecting.
Guy Boucher today announcing quickly that Dwayne Rolison gets back in the twine.
Yep. Face off here, rolls toward Niemi, and it's sent in just wide. It was Daniel Sedin who tried to jump around the San Jose defender. Now it comes out to Daniel at the right point. Slides it across. Edler. Casale back to Edler. Great give and go. A chance here was blocked in front of Niemi.
One too many passes. Great recovery in the middle of the ice there by Pavelski to make that check.
Edler to Daniel. Knocked away. Picked up Edler. A shot. That doesn't get through. Intercepted by Salo. Daniel out to Henrik. Rolls off his stick and Clough backhands it ahead. Taniguchi trying to catch up to it. Salo, good positioning.
Boy, the momentum swings in this second period have been fierce. Vancouver is just drilling San Jose this last couple of minutes.
Huskins is going to get to this loose puck.
And really, unlike Sedin, to have so much time at the right point, that San Jose really hemmed in, obviously. And two things happen. You give up a goal or you take a minor penalty, but Sedin fanned on the pass, which you don't see very often, fellas.
A lot of guys are fanning on pucks. The puck seems to be sticking a lot, Panger. I don't know what the ice is like down there.
Burrows for Vancouver in the first. Marlowe for now getting credit for the San Jose goal in the second. We go into the third period of Game 5 of the Western Conference Final tied at 1. Verizon Intermission Report. The guys will take a look at the Eastern Conference Final. Back in Vancouver, British Columbia, where the Canucks have a 3-1 lead in the series, but this Game 5 is 1-1 after 2. Let's go inside the glass, presented by BlackBerry with Darren Pang.
Thanks very much, David. Had a chance to talk to Rick Bowness, the assistant coach of the Vancouver Canucks, and he talked an awful lot about the breakouts of the Vancouver Canucks. He didn't think they were getting out of their zone clean enough, and Brian, he needs, and you would appreciate this, they want their forwards to be a lot lower to help support the defensemen coming out of their zone. They're one of the best five-man units that we have in the National Hockey League.
Those shorter passes and make sure the defense, those forwards come back down low, make it easier and more distinctive.
A steal, Daniel Sedin, wait, sends it toward the net, save. Rebound opportunity nearly there for Burrows, who has the only goal for Vancouver. Marlowe still to this point credited for the only goal, and a loose puck is going to be picked up by Pavelski to set a good. And when he missed the puck, it was an open net.
Tough reaction play there by Luongo. It's that old theory, when in doubt, get out. But he thought he had a beat on it. Instead, Pavelski beat him to the puck.
Tremendous work by Joe Pavelski, though, flying up the middle. This is just a clearing pass, and it goes off Pavelski's leg, and it catches Edler standing still, and Pavelski sees the goaltender coming out and just knocks it into the middle of the ice towards Setoguchi. Oh, what a brilliant play. I mean, that's just absolutely a brilliant play. I believe that was Daniel Sedin, 33, not 23, standing still at the blue line, but still, that's all Pavelski on the Corona Lake goal cam. You could get a good look at the finish.
Right in the middle of the net, but what an exceptionally great play there by Pavelski, knowing he's got to get the puck to the right side where Setoguchi is, and he does so.
And two guys that we've talked about that have needed to step up in this series, Setoguchi gets his first goal of the series, his seventh of the playoffs, and Pavelski, just a terrific read and an assist.
Well, early on in the series, we talked about the balance and spreading out to Thornton, Couture, and Pavelski at center ice and what kind of balance they had up against the balance of the Vancouver Canucks. But they've loaded up the top two lines for San Jose in this game, and it has made a big difference. There's Henrik Sedin, who was 33. It bounces over his stick. Look at Pavelski with the hustle there. Feels Luongo, and that's just perfection. All Setoguchi has to do is be calm and knock it into the empty net.
You know, I don't like this play by Luongo. I've been in that position where you're in no man's land, but you're going straight ahead on a play, and you know that there's two guys barreling in on you. Even if he gets a piece of it, there's still going to be a lot of danger. He wasn't sure that he was going to get to that puck. That's where you do it again. You stay back in there and you just play it as it lies.
Daniel Sedin sends it to the front. Angled away by Niemi. A shot from the point by Penev is just wide of the glove. Now Wellwood. Taken back by the Canucks. Daniel Sedin now to Henrik. Going to settle the puck down. Sends it toward the net. Locked up high on the glass. Still in play. Now White gets to it. Remember the game five in the last series against Nashville with a chance to close it out. It was tied going into the third. It was 2-2 that night, 1-1 here. And it was Joel Ward that was the hero in the third period for Nashville that helped extend that series to a game six.
Yeah, he quieted the crowd, didn't he?
He did. Now it's sent in wide of Luongo, indicating it would have been icing, but Jamal Mayers gets there to negate it. Now Desjardins sends it back again. Trying to keep it in. Hansen angled to the boards. Oh, look out. This puck takes a strange hop off the end boards, and Niemi came sliding out on his knees, but the Sharks got to the puck as Hamhuis stepped up on Desjardins in the neutral zone.
Yeah, that was a heads-up play by Huskins. Huskins saved a possible goal there. That was a wicked bounce off the stanchion.
Mason Raymond with speed. Kent Huskins incidentally got the second assist on the Setoguchi goal along with Pavelski. Now Klo is run into. The puck comes backward, picked up by Douglas Marie. Backhands it up the near side. Setoguchi has control. Carries into the Vancouver zone, hands it off to Pavelski to the net. Blocker to side by Luongo. Now Kessler chips it ahead for Higgins. And the Canucks just now have the same number of shots that they had in all of game four. And 13 shots, still pretty low, even with 16 minutes remaining.
It's still a 2-1 advantage for San Jose, who have 27 shots already.
Edler slides it in wide of Niemi. Now Vlasic gloves it along. Marlowe comes back. He'll get to it. Now a lead pass picked off by Henrik Sedin. Sends it far side. Burrows waits, shoots, and he sent it just wide on the glove side.
Vlasic
is down, and he is hurting badly. Now the officials can let this play go, but that is the situation that's becoming dangerous, and now they will wave it down. Joe Thornton having something to say to the referee Steve Cazzari, but
they're always going to argue that, hey, they don't want to give up scoring chances while a guy is hurt. I don't know if it's the follow-through from Burrow's stick. Burrow's has a glorious scoring chance, and Vlasic will come back through the middle. There's Burrow's with the chance.
Yeah,
it's the follow-through. And that was Vlasic's stick who possibly saved the goal. That was a terrific poke check. Look at that. Just as the release of Burrow's is happening, and then Burrow's stick comes up and slaps Vlasic across the face.
There's still that responsibility, even though it is a follow-through. follow through where that stick ends up here, right here, shot. And it's, you know, it's the stick of Vlasic first that blocks the follow through of Burrows, and then Burrows lose control of his stick with only one hand on it.
Yeah, that's a fine line, but that's the only time you don't get called for a high stick, though, Panger, is if it is a follow through on a shot, it is not a high sticking penalty. And he was still in the action of it there. And just the bottom line here is it looks like it hit him in the mouth. They got that towel on his mouth there.
They'll still control that. They'll still call that if there's a lack of control. If there's obvious recklessness with it and trying to embellish that it's a shot and a follow-through and you clip the guy. But anyway, Vlasic's going to go off. It looks like he's going to go off for some repairs with that towel around his mouth. But anxious moments for the San Jose Sharks with one man down and Burrows and the Canucks with full control.
Well, the faceoff to the left of the San Jose goal. No penalty. And the Sharks able to dodge a bullet as well now is Mitchell with a shot that got through the long one, trickled out on the far side, and the Mitchell follows through with a big hit. I agree with you, Brian. This has been Torrey Mitchell's best game.
Absolutely. This line has really done the best. All three of them are playing better. Heatley's playing better, Wellwood's playing better, and Mitchell's playing better. They're getting more out of everybody with these line changes on San Jose.
Oh, Heatley doesn't want to go to Lake Eugene just yet, fellas.
Wellwood across the line. Pulls up. Hands it off for Heatley. Now Mitchell with it again. Nice little play across the boil. Far side, Mitchell wanted it back. Then he tried to hit Wellwood. I thought he might shoot it there, Panger.
He should have.
Yeah, he should have for sure. The goalie's got to go all the way from his left to his right, post to post. That's an opportunity to at least put it towards the net and see what you get.
Both teams have done that on several occasions in this game. One extra pass back into the middle, trying to get a shot from the middle, and there isn't any room in the middle. It's another turnover.
Nice step up by Boyle in the neutral zone. Thornton with a shot. Blocker to side by Luongo. The Canucks get to it, and Burrows now sends it far side. Daniel Sedin for Henrik. Back to Daniel. Henrik again. Back to the late man. Hamhuis fakes. Oh, tried to set up Bieksa. Oh, Marlowe went awkwardly into the board, but appears to be all right as he right up to his skates. Couture tries to clear. Daniel Sedin holds it in. Blocked by Couture. What a keep in by Daniel. And then good support by Boyle.
And Couture might have got away with a little bit of a hook right there.
Yeah. I think Henrik Sedin was trying to point that out to the officials. Daniel cuts in. It's knocked off his stick to the boards. Henrik sends it out. Hennep now at the right point. Nice little play there to Daniel Sedin. Up the boards, Pavelski was challenged. Now Burrows takes over. Gives it to Henrik Sedin. Back for Daniel. Shot saved, made by Niemi.
They just make something out of nothing. There's small areas of the ice. They put on clinics, don't they?
Well, they sure do. Henrik is knocked down. Coming back is close with a shot saved by Luongo.
Oh, that was a heavy shot, too. He was trying to go high, knowing that Luongo would go down there, hit him in the upper chest there. A good shot by Klo.
Brian, keep your eye on Bieksa. He's in a great deal of pain over at the Vancouver bench. Hobbled off.
I think he got pulled down pretty hard by Thornton on his last shift.
Now Setoguchi, who has the go-ahead goal in this game five, flips it softly back into the Vancouver end. Dabble for Torres. Huskett drops it back but put too much on it. It was blocked by Torres, recovered by Desjardins. Now for Jamal Mayers. Jamal Mayers drives it right in on the Luongo. Desjardins, Mayers sends it back on the far side. Hansen is there, taps it away from again. LaPierre written into the boards right by the San Jose bench, and the play is offside. One goal here in the third period as players have to be separated. A great setup by Pavelski to Setoguchi. 2-1 Sharks.
Congratulations. You wrote a killer resume, nailed the interview, and scored your perfect job. You use new Mitchum Advanced Control. You and your armpits stayed calm, cool, and rocked it. Though you did lie about being fluent in Dutch. Now the owner of Going Dutch Inc. has hired you to be his personal translator starting right now. You might cry, but your pits won't. That's because Mitchum gives you 48 hours of protection. Perfect for a word recell. Oh, that's Dutch for conundrum. Mitchum. Maximum strength, ultimate protection, 48 hours a day.
It is the newest.
Even newer. Oh.
Everything else is obsolete.
I just bought this one.
What the?
3D.
Oh, whoa, wait. Oh, 4D TV? Stupid.
You got the wrong TV, silly head.
The new buyback program.
You buy it now, we buy it back when the new thing comes out.
Any minute.
Hey, you know they're not coming back.
Really? But they just bought me.
Get over it, Tubby. They're in Vegas. And they left us here to rot. Can't blame them. With all the five-star restaurants, spas, designer golf courses, even pool parties.
Wait, I'm gonna rot?
Welcome back to the Stanley Cup Conference Finals on Versus, presented by Progressive Insurance.
Well, two guys that we want to keep our eye on, Bieksa and Thornton, as this game goes forward. Thornton on the last play. Watch this, number 19 in white. Watch him kick the foot out a little bit for Bieksa. Bieksa never sees it happening. He went down really hard, and that he went directly to the bench. Hurt. That shakes you up. The hip area, the backside area, your back, that whole thing. When you get your foot kicked out from behind you, that is painful, and you can see it.
There's a guy, Bieksa, that's had some devastating injuries. That Achilles tear.
Yeah.
Sandy Salo had the same thing. That's bad stuff for a hockey player.
Now, we've talked about the depth of this Vancouver defense, how it's been tested, and there was so much made about the job that Mike Gillis did in the offseason, and yet they never got their entire group of six together until the playoffs started.
The good news is the X is out here on this next shift.
Yeah. Big collision. Douglas Murray, Mason Raymond goes down, and Thornton drops it back for Boyle.
When you say Douglas Murray and big collision, can you say anything else?
That's right. Anytime you're right. Doesn't matter how big the guy is he's hitting. It's a big collision. Marlowe for Thornton now. As the Sharks try to go to work in the offensive zone, Huskins with a fluttering shot that goes well wide. Logan Couture is going to track this puck down. Brings it up the wall, now sends it to the net. Knocked down by Bieksa, and Marlowe just fanned on a loose puck.
Couture was trying to get with that one through to Joe Thornton, who was coming out from behind the net but got blocked in front.
Off the stick of Heatley. Now picked up by Heatley again. Gets a shot away. He doesn't miss by much. Boy, that's one of the rare times in a shooting spot that we've seen Heatley rip that great shot of his. As we take another look at the Pizza Hut favorite matchup, the two goaltenders, Luongo and Niemi. We showed you their numbers recently coming in, and here's what they've done tonight. Luongo, obviously the busier goaltender, as you take a look at their records when having a chance to eliminate the opposition or facing elimination.
Well, this faceoff should not be outside. It should be inside. This shot, a good one, goes right off the glove or the shoulder there of Roberto Luongo doing the splits. Yeah, I think that's Heatley's best scoring chance. They are going to change it right now. Yeah. Joe Thornton right beside me here. He's looking at the referee like, guys, how can you not see that?
Yeah, it's a good pickup there. Roberto Luongo has made some fabulous saves in this game. Yes, he took a gamble and lost on that Setoguchi goal, but it was a brilliant play by Pavelski on it. Otherwise, Luongo's made four or five just absolutely brilliant saves in this game.
Well, Pierre with a clean faceoff win, and the Canucks able to get it down the ice. Sharks try to turn it back the other way. Can't head back to play it off the boards. Hanson redirects center ice, stepping up Ian White.
It's still imperative in this game, and one of the reasons why Vancouver's had success, they gained the zone rather easily, and the San Jose Sharks have got to have confidence in closing gaps. There's a lot of space through the neutral zone that's allowing Vancouver to get in the offensive zone.
San Jose Sharks also have been very disciplined. They've only been called for one minor penalty so far in this game.
A good breakout right there. A good little pass by Huskins to Setoguchi.
Setoguchi didn't get that puck deep. It was blocked to center ice. Huskins, though, able to hammer it right back in.
That's just careless. That's a couple of times in this game Setoguchi's done that. If you have to make sure. It's an easy thing. You're just dumping it in the end of the rink. Get it right.
Now Burrows holds up inside the line. Edler gets a stick on it.
Oh, another turnover there.
Henrik picked the pocket of Klow. Hands it off for Daniel below the goal line. Henrik setting up at the top of the blue paint. It's angled out off the boards for Edler. Walks the line, changes the angle. Shot was blocked by Pavelski, but it doesn't come outside the zone. Burrows sends it to Henrik. In front for Daniel. That's blocked to the side, but recovered by the Canucks. Daniel sends it across. Good read there by Setoguchi. He got back to negate Henrik Sedin as this puck goes out of play. Next week, Geico presents the NHL Stanley Cup Final on NBC and Versus. It all starts on NBC with Games 1 and 2, and don't miss coverage of Games 3 and 4 on Versus. History will be made on NBC and Versus.
A couple of turnovers for the San Jose Sharks, and when the Sedins are out there, it's not going to be a good thing. There's Burrows behind the net. Henrik threads it through. Nice job by Niemi to cut that one off. Then Daniel looking for Henrik, and it was Setoguchi at the last moment who checked Henrik Sedin, and then they ended up getting the puck out of the zone and into the bench. So a face-off outside here for San Jose, relieving some big-time pressure.
You're right about that alert play with the blocker by Niemi. You know, he's just trying to cut it off, and even though he punches it out to the middle of the ice, it's better than the alternative, which would have been a tap-in on the other side.
Niemi's been strong tonight, Panger.
Well, he has, and none of us are surprised, are we? I mean, the way that he has, the mental strength that he has,
yep.
Backs against the wall, all that kind of stuff.
Sharks
overall, it's been a pretty good,
yep.
Really, really good game by the San Jose Sharks. And it's been an excellent hockey game all the way around.
Well, a lot has been made of the guys offensively that have struggled for San Jose, but it's their goals against an overall defensive play that has taken a huge dip from their numbers in the regular season. But for now, San Jose's given up only one, and they have a 2-1 lead facing elimination.
Ford America, Pizza Hut's $10 any deal is back. Any pizza, any size, any crust, any toppings is now just $10 when you carry out. That's right, the $10 any deal is back. But hurry in, this deal is for a limited time only. Only at your Pizza Hut.
Because I had a good teacher, I learned about more than cars.
I like responsibility.
Doing things right.
Dad.
Introducing Valvoline Next Gen. Backed by the Valvoline Engine Guarantee Program, it's 50% recycled oil, 100% Valvoline protection.
Get ready to become leaner, sexier, and more defined than you ever thought possible with Ripfire and the performance-boosting Accelerate formula.
Everybody says, you know, do you have a trainer? What are you doing? What's your secret? What's your diet? And I say, it's all Ripfire.
Now you can harness the awesome power of nitric oxide, helping you push harder, go longer, and dig deeper than ever before.
Muscles just been popping out everywhere. I go to brush my teeth and I notice a new muscle. It's crazy.
Rip Fire works. And today, during the Rip Fire Challenge, we're going to prove it to you at no risk by sending you a trial supply of Rip Fire absolutely free.
First time I actually see like obliques, like these kind of muscles going on over here.
Don't waste another minute. Just go online right now before they're gone. Because if you're not working out with Ripfire,
then you're not getting ripped.
Limit one free bottle per customer. Go to ripfireresults.com.
Game 5, Western Conference Final here on Versus. 2-1, Sharks lead, trying to avoid elimination. Let's get to our Subway storyline.
First goal of the game, to Sedins, to Burrows. That's the way the first period ended. It was 1-1. Then Patrick Marleau, this is a deflection on a shot from Boyle on the power play. That tied up at 1-1. That's how the second period ended. And then a brilliant play from Pavelski, knocking it over to Setoguchi, who puts it in the empty net. And that's where we're at right now, 2-1 San Jose.
And if it stays Marleau's goal, his 53rd career playoff goal, and an interesting point that Liam made during the second intermission, that if it stands, it will tie Marleau with Jeremy Roenick with a couple of other guys in terms of career playoff goals. After JR had some rather strong comments about the play of Marleau in the last round, as Boyle now across the line sends it in deep. Centering pass, just picked off by Henrik Sedin as Couture was going to step into that.
Yeah, he could feel Couture coming. That's a great player.
And it gets away from Murray. Burrows then overskates it. Looks like Burrows and Daniel Sedin were going to have a clean 2-on-1.
Yeah, they should have there. That was a complete mishandle by Burrows. Great chance. It was a 2-on-1 from the blue line end.
I don't know how that got through Douglas Murray at the left point. I don't know how that snuck underneath him.
Al Thornton starts it back the other way and just puts it in deep at the end of his shift with 9 minutes straight up remaining here in the third period. The Sharks with a 2-1 lead.
Look at the aggressiveness now on the line change. Dan Boyle, the defenseman, realizing that all the rest of his teammates were changing, he went in on the forecheck. Smart. He's got three or four guys coming in behind him. It's a good time for a defenseman to forecheck. Keep the pressure on.
Wallin sends his puck in deep. Heatley trying to get his stick free, and he finally does from Hamhuis. Now Heatley out of the corner with it. Nice diagonal pass. Wallin sends it off the end boards. Mitchell able to win that battle for the puck, but good stick by Hamhuis And the Canucks clear it back the other way. Going to be icing unless LaPierre gets there ahead of White. I think they both missed the puck, yeah. And then Bahlin able to get up and touch it.
That was a close call, but both guys did definitely miss that. And here comes Burrows, and Douglas Murray tries to get it, gets through him somehow. And look at Burrows. Burrows is so frustrated with himself after that. The puck was rolling, and it was difficult for him. And then the line change, Burrows and Thornton crossing paths.
Yeah, he's pretty good shoulder to shoulder. I'm just looking to see if Joe was wincing or anything like that. You know, when you know, we're talking about the injury that he took in the last game. Nothing whatsoever. Good play by Burrows.
Yeah.
Subtle play right there.
Yeah. Oops, sorry, Joe.
Yep.
Now Huskins sends it back in deep. Pavelski almost got it to the front for Setoguchi. It was blocked by Bieksa. On the cycle, the referee Kozari trying to get out of the way as the Canucks get it out to center ice. Huskins blocks it, Klo chips it across. Now Vlasic plays it ahead to Setoguchi. He gets it in deep.
Yes, he does the right thing right there. You're that close to the blue line, that gray area inside and outside that blue line to get it deep, and he does so even though he knows he's going to get hit. But a terrific play by Huskins to close the line here in the offensive zone just a moment ago.
Now Desjardins tries to send it back toward Luongo, who knocked it down and able to cover up after he had lost his goal stick. And reminding you something that we touched on very early in the show, last four times that the Vancouver Canucks have had a lead with a chance to close out a series in Game 5 at home, they've lost going back to 0-3 against Minnesota, Dallas in overtime here in 0-7, and the two this year, 5-0 against Chicago, and the 4-3 loss against Nashville.
Vigneault's got to be happy with the way his team's playing right now, though. They've got the puck more. They're putting pressure on San Jose. San Jose sitting back quite a bit. They do have the 2-1 lead. Still lots of time. It's those momentum swings, though. You have to be careful if you're San Jose. You sit back up all the time. If Vancouver can score, then you try to step on the gas again, and the gas pedal isn't quite there.
Boy, did Vancouver stretch that out, huh?
Yeah,
pass from their own, behind their own net, almost to the inside of the far blue line.
But the Sharks come back the other way now as Jamal Mayers puts it to the corner. Fourth line getting a little bit of ice time here for Tom McClellan. Again, took a hit there from Salo. As the pace of the game starts to pick up a little bit, up and down the ice we go. Edler for Higgins sets it up. Kessler's shot was blocked.
What a block by Wallin.
That was a bad forecheck by San Jose. You had two forwards going up the ice when Vancouver was coming back at them with the puck with numbers. And you had Thornton and McGinn both get caught in the neutral zone.
Nice play by Thornton here to set up Couture with a drive and a save by Luongo. Came right out to the top of the blue paint to challenge. Now Couture sends it in deep. Marlow could not control it. Bieksa gets to it now. Under 6.5 remaining in the third period. The Canucks one win away from getting to the Stanley Cup Final for the first time since 1994, but they trail 2-1 to the Sharks, who are trying to force a Game 6 at HP Pavilion. It would take place Thursday night. A steal by Daniel Sedin in front, looking for Henrik, but it's picked up by Heatley. Heatley to center ice, backhands it along the boards, in behind Luongo.
Good job defensively by Heatley, collapsing down low. He made the defensive play.
And he comes back there in the neutral zone. Good back check there on Daniel Sedin. Wellwood pushes it ahead into the Vancouver zone. Rafi Torres down. Christopher Tanev plays it all the way down the ice. Didn't connect there with LaPierre. This is going to be icing. And a faceoff all the way back into the Vancouver zone with 5:38 remaining here in regulation time. Beginning Friday, June 10th, Versus brings you inside the third jewel of the Triple Crown. Unprecedented coverage of the Belmont Stakes begins June 10th, leading up to the race Saturday, June 11th on NBC. And we will not have a Triple Crown winner again. We have not had one since Brian Engblom was a rookie in the National Hockey League 1978, when Affirmed won the Triple Crown.
Oh, wasn't that many years ago, was it, Brian?
No. I don't remember the race.
I'm sure you do. Serge Savard was your teammate.
He remembers.
Loose puck poked away by Luongo, recovered by Klo. Couldn't get it through the traffic in front of the Vancouver net.
Luongo had no idea where that was. He was looking the other way.
Rafi Torres picks up a loose puck, saved by Niemi. Douglas Murray able to clear it out to center ice. Bouncing puck taken by Klo. All the way back into the Vancouver end. Kessler. Little redirect. Intercepted by White. Right back toward the front of the net. Blocked by Kessler. Oh, Sharks get it right back.
Kessler, he looked after, he was trying to explode through the neutral zone, kind of laboring for a split second, but he's okay. Looks like it anyway.
Now Couture with Thornton and Marlowe. Now Ballard. Fans on that clearing attempt. Marlowe unable to take advantage of it, though. Mason Raymond comes back now for the Canucks. Sends it far side, a bouncing puck. Mitchell able to clear it.
Late in the game, though, you're right, Brian, you're talking about the ice before. It's obviously, in any building this time of year, it is starting to really hobble around out there. The rolling passes are few and far between.
Yeah, rolling pucks. It makes it tough for one-timers. Just controlling the puck and making the safe play. And that's what you have to do in these critical situations. Yeah. If it is rolling, you have to make the conservative play.
Easier for the team holding the lead than it is for the offensive team trying to make plays.
Here's Heatley. Gets a shot away and a pad save by Luongo.
Another good, strong offensive move, though, by Heatley. His best game, too.
Burrows across the line, drops it back. Henrik Sedin for Edler jumping into the play. Edler to the front of the net. Daniel Sedin couldn't get a stick out of Burrows. Able to get it to Daniel below the goal line. To the corner for Henrik. Quickly back for Daniel. Given a shove there by Huskins. Now back for Henrik again. Out to Bieksa. One-timer flutters in wide on Niemi. Huskins able to get to this loose puck. The Canucks putting out all kinds of pressure. Looking
nice
for a tying goal, but that puck is cleared by the Sharks, and it won't go far enough for icing.
Huskins with a terrific defensive play. He was in terrific position against the Sedins the whole time. Turned the puck over and made sure. Got it out of the zone and got off.
LaPierre for Hanson jumps off of his stick. Not a lot of whistles. The clock becoming an ally of the San Jose Sharks as we hit 3 minutes straight up. Remaining here in regulation time. It's a 2-1 lead for the Sharks. Trying to extend this series. Boyle with a hip check to separate LaPierre from the puck. Rafi Torres comes up for the Canucks. Knocked away from him. And chipped off the boards and out to center ice. Thornton pinned the glass right away by Salo.
Good job by eating it, though. He had no play to make, but he doesn't want to cough it up on the defensive side of it. Now he's got a broken stick. He's going to look for a change.
Now McGinn one-hands this puck in deep. Battling against Hamus, the goal stick of Luongo comes out of his hand. He's going to try to pick it up here.
Great work by McGinn there. He was a big threat going to the net. Stayed hard on the puck. And look at the time spent in the offensive zone here by McGinn.
Burrows was hovering around the far blue line.
Yeah, exactly.
It took the bench of the San Jose Sharks to let the defenseman know that he was back there.
Henrik for Burrows. Now Edler, another minute has gone by. 2 minutes straight up remaining here in the third period. Now White and Vallin digging for it. As it comes to Heatley. Backhands it out to center ice. Taken here by Marlowe. Wellwood coming into the zone. Marlowe pulls up, waits. Heatley coming as well. Heatley couldn't get the shot away. Great back check there.
Daniel Sedin. Oh, that's terrific. That's a huge scoring chance there for Heatley. That's hard work by Daniel Sedin.
Now Daniel drops it back. Mason Raymond with a shot. Niemi the save. Empty net down to our right. And the San Jose Sharks come up with a loose puck to center ice. Marlowe just got to the red line and got it deep.
I don't think Marlowe even knew that Luongo was out of the net yet. He was tired. He wanted to make the right play. He got the red line and dumped it in deep.
Yeah, he never looked. You're right. Mason Raymond trying to get this puck in deep. Remember, both teams have used their timeouts.
It's going to be icing.
Icing is the call.
The Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus are brought to you by Warner Brothers Pictures' Green Lantern in theaters June 17th. And by Progressive, making it easy to shop for car insurance.
Face off to the right of Luongo, who has to come back in with a minute eight. Remaining here in regulation time. 2-1 lead for the San Jose Sharks. Thornton and Kessler, it ends up in the corner. Salo has it. Luongo starting to make his way to the bench. Now it comes to Kessler again, immediately challenged by Thornton. Bouncing puck, Boyle got it to center ice. Chipped ahead, backhanded by Chloe, he's going to miss the net. But he got it to center ice, so there's no icing. 50 seconds now remaining here in the third period. Daniel Sedin ahead for Kessler. Pretty good burst of speed there, but broken up and cleared by Pavelski.
Strong execution, great positioning here by San Jose as Vancouver's throwing the kitchen sink at him here.
Boyle wraps it around and he got enough on it to get it by Bieksa. This will be icing on the touch-up by Hamhuis, and we're down to 28.2 seconds. Don't forget, after the game, Stanley Cup Hockey Central presented by Bud Light. Complete analysis of this Game 5 and a preview of tomorrow night's Game 6 of the Eastern Conference Final between the Bruins and the Tampa Bay Lightning.
This is where these situations where Vancouver's been really good on faceoff, especially Kessler.
Kessler and Thornton to the left of the Emmy. Draw control by Kessler. Out to the line, Edler. Hands it off on the boards, Henrik Sedin. Chips it in deep for Burrows. Now for Daniel. Lost it momentarily. Burrows to Henrik. Out to the line, Edler. 15 seconds remaining for the net. Goal!
Face-off. Great work by the Vancouver Canucks. Everybody go to their station. Control the puck. Finally get it back to the point. Watch 17 blue in front of the net when the shot comes. He will definitely redirect this one. Antti Niemi looked at pretty good position, Panger, but it changed direction on him big time.
It's a terrific redirection right there, and it finds its way through Niemi. But it's a clean face-off win by Kessler, the right-hand shot that establishes the calmness from the Vancouver Canucks to make a play.
Just his second goal of this series. He had the 5-on-3 goal that started the scoring in Game 4. 6 seconds remaining here. Torres runs right over the top of the defenseman. A shot nearly gets all the way through to Niemi.
This has been the best hockey game of this series so far. So much more flow. And the excitement level obviously off the chart right here as Vancouver bails themselves out and scores late.
You know, the Sharks tried to get the officials' attention on the icing call by Boyle. It goes around the boards and it actually clips right there the shoulder of Sedin. Goes all the way down the ice. Ryan Clough tried to tell the officials. The Sharks did. The officials didn't see that happening. It goes back for a face-off in the offensive zone. Kessler wins it. Wow. And game tied, in overtime.
Yeah, that's a great catch there, Panger, because I knew that Clough was really upset about something. Obviously, the goal was legal, but it went back to that situation. We'll gather ourselves here, send you back to the studio after this break. 2-2, we're headed to overtime here in Game 5. Time, playoff hockey, Western Conference Finals, Game 5 with the survival of the San Jose Sharks on the line. We'll take a look at our Bud Light Impact player, and it's Vancouver captain Henrik Sedin, who has assisted on the last 6 Vancouver goals in this series.
And he started off the very first shift of the game playing with his brother. They just dominated the play. He has had scoring chances in this game, moved the puck around, created all kinds of offense, and that was the pass that he made to Alex Burrows. That was the first goal of the game. And this is the final assist where he throws it to the front of the net. 19:46 on the clock. Henrik Sedin threw it. Kessler deflected it. That's why we're in overtime.
Bad luck, obviously, for San Jose on that clear out by Boyle going off the shoulder of Sedin, as we showed before the break. Should never have been an icing. Should never have been a face-off to the left of Niemi.
Overtime underway. Canucks score, they go to the Stanley Cup Final. Sharks score, we go to a Game 6 Thursday night at HP Pavilion. Salo pitches up the right side. It comes out to the line. Henrik Sedin moves it along for Daniel. Back to Henrik. Daniel out of the corner. Spins behind the net. Goes back to Henrik. Back to Daniel. Good stick by Pavelski, but the Canucks still have it. Now here's Burrows out of the corner with it.
Oh, knocked off the puck.
What a hit.
Great hit by Pavelski. That's playing the body, folks. That shook Burrows up. Burrows has had a terrific game. He's played 23 minutes. 3.5 of it killing penalties, which takes a lot out of you. Number 14 in blue wants to make a little move to the front. That's just good, solid defense by number 8 in white coming back on the play. That's filling in all right in the slot area.
He doesn't get that knee out of the tracks, does he? It's right where it began, but close to being knee on knee.
Well, after the icing, the faceoff to the left of the Emmy. Kessler tied up on the draw, but it picked up by Higgins. Higgins behind the net, wraparound stopped by Niemi. Out to the line, held in by Hamhuis. That's blocked out on the high slot. Huskins hammers it off the board, got enough on it to clear it out to center ice.
Vancouver feeding off, obviously, game tying goal, a chance to go to the Stanley Cup Finals. They've carried that momentum here early on in overtime.
Now Kessler, Higgins behind the net. Sends it out to the right point, Bieksa. Shot low and wide. Kessler wheels it back in just wide.
Good positioning again, though, by Pavelski. He was on Kessler. Otherwise, Kessler would have had a much quicker attack at the net.
Incidentally, the last time the Canucks went to the Stanley Cup Final was 1994. It was on this date, May 24th, that an overtime goal was scored by Greg Adams in the conference final that sent the Canucks to the Stanley Cup Finals for the second time in their history. So will May 24th be the magic date again?
I did that game with the late Tom Mees.
Oh, that's right, Hanger. Corey Mitchell ahead now for Heatley. Heatley takes it wide, throws it in on Luongo. San Jose Sharks are 5-0 in overtime. They have been terrific in these situations. The Canucks are 2-2.
Good start to this overtime for Vancouver. Domination, getting the puck low, spending a lot of time in San Jose's end.
Now Ballard with a rush. Shot deflected and trickles it on the Emmy, and he holds it there. Now you take a look at the players that have scored goals in overtime in their careers. Pavelski, Setoguchi, Baleen leading the way. He had two in the finals there that one year.
Yeah.
And you look at Burrows and Daniel Sedin, each with a pair. Ryan Kessler with one that he scored in the Nashville series, game 3.
Amazing. Baleen, the only defenseman on that list, and he's got 3 of them.
And Kessler had a real good wraparound attempt, too. Niemi went paddled down to stop it.
Hamhuis held it in, but it's taken over by Torrey Mitchell. He starts it back. Wrist shot. Blocker saved by Luongo. Now Burrows. It was the overtime hero in Game 7 against Chicago. Now Couture pulls up at the line. Drops it back for Joel Thornton. Goes back to Couture. Now to Huskins. Sends it in wide off the end boards. Thornton. The exit got it for the Canucks. Daniel Sedin across for Henrik. There's that set play, that long dump in. It'll be picked up by Daniel. Now for Burrows. Wraps it around. Henrik waiting on the near side. Hands it off in deep for Daniel. Now it comes back to Henrik again. Henrik being watched by Huskins, keeping him to the outside. Couture with an intercept.
That's good patience by San Jose there, especially against the Sedins, because of the way they've handled the puck and manipulated plays. Huskins did a good job there again.
Close there, San Jose. Premature hopping on the ice.
Kessler sent it in wide. Now Mason Raymond. Head up, hands it off, Kessler shot, that changes direction, it goes up high on the glass, Saddle sends it back in wide. Here is Kessler with it again. He tied the game, he sets it up for Saddle, who hammers it well wide, and missed the net from that angle, that puck comes all the way out.
Huskins will have a chance to get off the ice, he was gone tired. He started to make the line change and then had to go back out there because of the quick up play that Vancouver had.
Now Ian White. Across the line for Klo. Sends it in on the Luongo. Steers it aside. Comes up the near side. Pavelski. Put the defenseman's spot at the point. Sends it far side. Klo has a jump off his stick. Now Setoguchi. Twice an overtime hero in these playoffs for the San Jose Sharks. Here is Klo. Hands it off to Pavelski with a shot that was blocked. Back to Ian White. Intercepted by Yannick Hansen. He starts it with his terrific speed. Ooh. Boy, that was a dangerous play, and if the linesman hadn't have been there, there may have been a penalty on that play, but I think it was the official to read it.
There should have been. Absolutely, yeah. That was a trip. Ian White was beaten on the play cleanly by Hansen, stuck his legs up.
Saved by Luongo. Murray, did he hold it in? No. The late offside here, and now it will be called.
That's a bad break for Hansen, because Hansen was just steaming down the wing. Yes, the linesman was in the way, but watch number 9 in white. He is cleanly beaten on the play. That's a clip or a trip or anything you want.
No
but
question.
The referees let him go.
Yeah.
I mean, Hansen, that's slow motion, so you don't get a sense of how fast he was going and how slow White was going. Kessler and the rest of the boys losing their mind on the Vancouver team.
The referee Walkham on the ice pointed to Vancouver's bench to the linesman. From his vantage point, he just thought that he tripped over the linesman.
Yeah.
Clearly, you were correct there. It was the skate in the leg of White who was couldn't close that gap. He was kind of a no man's land.
Well, the Canucks got a break on a non-call late in regulation, and the San Jose Sharks get the benefit of a non-call here in overtime. A steal by Marlowe. Pushes it now for Thornton. Thornton. With some help from Marlowe, Thornton has it again. Lays it up the boards. Logan Couture fakes the pass to the point against Rafi Torres. Now it comes to Thornton one more time. Back to the line. Boyle tees it up. Slides it across. Douglas Murray a shot. Save. Rebound. Chance to stop. And just missed the stick of Thornton on a second rebound. Here's Boyle with a shot. And a blocker saved by Luongo. He put it right up off the netting as the Sharks come with their best pressure of this first overtime.
Well, quick hands there by Patrick Marlowe. It was a shot by Boyle again from the point. That was the combo that scored the first goal of this game. There's Boyle. Marlowe with the rebound. And then the good idea to try to get it to Joe Thornton on the second try. Look at Marlowe. Once he hears Thornton coming, gets it over to him, but it goes between his feet.
Joe wanted the next one, though. He didn't want that to be a shot on goal by Boyle. He laid out to his left, so Boyle would make the pass to the right. But Boyle didn't see that option right there. I think Joe really wanted that puck. He was tapping his stick on the ice.
Mitchell wins the draw. It comes back to the line. Vlasic with a shot into the glove of Luongo.
Good save there by Luongo. He sees it all the way. But when you go to the very end of the third period, as we showed you before break, the San Jose Sharks desperately wanted the linesman to see that and make the call, nullifying the icing. That did not happen. And because of the faceoff win by Kessler off the icing that shouldn't have been called, Vancouver's able to tie up the game.
Yeah, the puck went around the glass and hit Daniel Sedin in the shoulder, but they just didn't detect it.
Now Salo under pressure from Mitchell to Daniel Sedin left wing side. Rink wide now for Burrows. Burrows and Kessler scoring in regulation for Vancouver. Here is Mitchell, winds up with a shot, right hand saved by Luongo. Now Baldwin with a chance.
Reading this play really well. Danny Heatley to Wellwood. Wellwood walking down the slot. Excellent 1-2 combo there. There's Mitchell with an initial shot. Nice save by Luongo. And then here's Heatley. Backhand pass. Wellwood striding into it. Beautiful shot. Better save.
Well, Luongo's not on his heels on the goal line. He's out there on top of the crease reading the play nicely. And that kind of wrist shot, easier to detect than maybe a heavier slap shot.
White up a faceoff. Wick set of Gucci tied up. Gets it on the backhand. He lifted it up too high. And Hughes angles it off the boards, out of the line. Good keep in by White. Ryan Close sends it back down deep. Marlowe and Setoguchi with the San Jose goals in regulation. Ooh, the stick of Bolling comes up. I think he definitely caught it.
There's no referee's hand up.
Jason Raymond, yep. They're letting it go.
Well, it was a good pinch by Bolling, but he gets away with one here. I mean, his stick clearly comes up and gets Higgins.
Centering attempt by Pavelski, knocked away to the line. White slides it across for Bolling. Bolling sends it in deep. Here's Pavelski with a shot that's blocked. Pavelski gets it back. He sends it to the right point. Ian White back to the front. Redirect. Get it. A save made by Luongo. And he covers up.
That went off the skate of Clough.
Yeah, it sure did. Clough was moving back out toward his own defenseman and went off the inside of his skate and changed direction. There's Pavelski out to the point. White with a heads-up shot. And there's the redirection. And Luongo has to be really sharp.
Well, good save. Pavelski's really seeing the ice. He's making plays. And there's the high stick right there.
Yeah.
You see how low Higgins is?
Yeah.
He's down low. He's got his face down low. And I thought he might have lost a tooth when he spit the bit when he came back up.
Yeah, I don't know if that was a mouth guard. Something did come out of his mouth. That was Mason Raymond.
Draw controlled by the Sharks. Good shot fake there by Boyle. He backed everybody out. Now a long backhand hoister goes off a stick and off the end boards. Now Logan Couture hands it off for Thornton. Thornton drops it back for Boyle. Boyle tries to get it to the blue paint area. Never got all the way through. A real battle along the back of the net, and the puck stays up on the back of the net long enough to get a whistle.
I was watching the trainer, Brian, tend to Higgins on the bench. And we'll keep our eye here to see if something comes out of his mouth. It looked to me like looking over at the bench, I could peer over there, and it looked like his part of his tooth definitely wasn't there.
Yeah, it was Mason Raymond, but the stick did come up really high. On this last shift here, Dan Boyle, too, 5-on-5 situation, extremely aggressive, going down low inside the zone to keep pressure on.
Clean face-off win by Marlowe. Douglas Murray backhands it along the boards. Good job by Edler on Thornton, prevented Thornton from getting that puck where he likes to control it, but this is going to be icing against the Canucks.
Kessler never got his stick down. That puck was dropped before he was set. Look for a little conversation here between Kessler and the linesman. You see this conversation right here. First stick's got to be Marlowe, the visitor. And it looked like Kessler was lifting back up, thinking it was a premature drop, maybe. He wasn't prepared for it.
Now Edler lifts this puck in deep. Douglas Murray with Mason Raymond right on him. Logan Couture gloves the puck down, moves it ahead for Marlowe. Marlowe able to chip it past Ballard.
And on that faceoff, just the fact that Marlowe was taking it, not Joe Thornton, you know that the wear and tear must be adding up for Thornton, too. We've seen that in different occasions in this game. He's got the upper body injury. We're not sure, but Thornton usually takes those draws.
Here's Heatley with a chance. Fires it low and just wide.
Heatley's coming alive in this game.
He is. Heatley has it again. A bouncing puck sets it up for Mitchell. Fans on the shot attempt. Now it's taken by Mason Raymond. He gets it across the line. Floats in on the Emmy, and he has it there. He will hold it there as we take a look at that Danny Heatley opportunity.
By far, his best game of the series. He's had multiple chances. That one, he didn't have much to look at there, but he did get the shot towards the net. He's been very aggressive. He's been getting open a lot more than he has prior in any game in this series.
You see the numbers that Darren Pang talked about earlier. His playoff numbers as a San Jose Shark.
He's had a strong game here. Creating chances, moving his feet, makes some good passes. That was a good entry into the zone. Wellwood drops it to Thornton. Thornton gains his zone, waits for Healy to get an open spot.
Neutral zone. Pavelski couldn't handle it cleanly. Now it comes back for Henrik Sedin. Backhand hoister across now for Daniel. Daniel to the front of the net. And Henrik was tied up there by Vlasic. The officials have let an awful lot go.
And the coaches of Vancouver standing up there on the bench, waving their arms.
Now taking it wide. Here's Huskins. Across the line, missed Pavelski.
Oh, look over. Out here.
Here comes Daniel Sedin. Waves, cuts to the middle. Shot in the right pad. Saved by the Emmy. Now Pavelski along with Setoguchi. Setoguchi waits. Tried to go high glove. Missed the net. Now Clough throws it back in deep. It jumps over the stick of Setoguchi. Pitching down the right side was Baleen. Coming over to help out Setoguchi. And the puck recovered here by Henrik Sedin. White backhands it off the near boards to center ice. Clough just chips it back into the Vancouver end. We're approaching the halfway mark of the first overtime. LaPierre across the line. Takes a look. Right pass. Avery was in front of an open net. Volley able to clear.
Miami looked like he might have overcommitted there on that short side, Brian. Was there a lot of room over there?
Yes. there sure was. And the shot from the bad angle off the far pad. Panger, that's the standard thing that players are taught. It gives a rebound in the middle of the ice, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Going to be an icing here. With 10:05 remaining in the overtime.
And the last shift for Huskins coming up the ice. He ends up turning the puck over. And Daniel Sedin ends up going in on goal.
Good scoring chance, too, to change the angle like that. You know, he just brought it right into the middle of the ice a little bit more. Tough save to make. Miami makes an excellent save with his right pad. Vancouver buying some time, and Walcombe is really lecturing Hansen.
There's the turnover, and Daniel Sedin, I'm kind of surprised that he didn't give the puck to Hansen. He ended up going alone on his own. Hansen was coming laterally across the blue line. If he had given it to him quick, they might have orchestrated a bit of a two-on-one going from the blue line in. But Huskins up on the play, and the turnover really got San Jose in trouble there.
Thornton tossed out. Marleau against Kessler. Marleau wins it cleanly. Back to Douglas Murray. Hammers it in wide on Luongo. Ballard able to play it to the near boards. Keep in mind on the next whistle, if we don't have a goal, they will come out and scrape the ice as we pass the halfway mark of this first overtime. Yannick Hansen, that shot was blocked by Murray. Murray chops at it. It stays right there with him. Now coming over to help out is Marleau. Chips it behind the net. Boyle. Checked by Kessler. Here is Hansen with it. Hansen tried to backhand it to the point. It was blocked by the Shark. Now Douglas Murray again. Higgins in there. Murray using that big body of his. Now the puck comes free. Recovered by the Sharks. Taken back by Higgins. Recovered again. And Thornton plays it past Kessler. Picked up by Couture. One-on-one against Hamhuis with a shot that's blocked by Luongo. He will hold it there. So with 9:05 remaining here with the overtime and we get a whistle, they'll come out and scrape the ice. And let's take you back and show you who the overtime heroes have been, starting with San Jose. They are 5-for-5. It started in game one against L.A. with Pavelski, then Setoguchi. This was the game, Brian, that the Sharks trailed 4-0 to come back and win it. Then Thornton ended the series in L.A. in overtime. Then it was Ben Ferriero with the only goal of that game and a 1-0 win. And then Setoguchi again in game three in Detroit. And for the Vancouver Canucks, game seven, how about that one? From Alex Burrows.
That was a big-time slap shot. And then in the Nashville series, Ryan Kessler in front of the net with the redirection, not unlike the game-tying goal that he's got here tonight from the same place, right on the edge of the blue paint.
See the numbers on Kessler, what he's done. He touches so many areas of the game, as coaches like to say. Face-off, scoring, defensively.
And he's probably down about 4 or 5 minutes in this game because he got hurt. He was on the forecheck there, shorthanded, and he just pulled up lame. You can see how badly he was hurting when he went to the bench. Came back, obviously feeling a whole lot better after scoring that goal, and he hasn't shown any signs in this overtime, or actually since he came back, from whatever it was that he pulled or hurt. He has played hard. So you got two of the main centers in this game. Kessler, who pulled up lame and came back, and of course, Joe Thornton, who was hurt coming into this game, having been hurt and not finished game four.
Pavelski and Kessler on the draw. Kessler wins it cleanly. Salo blocked by Setoguchi. Coming up is Klo to help out. Setoguchi out of the corner. Chips it far side. Bolling gets to it with a skate. Throws it back in deep. Klo protecting the puck against Salo. Setoguchi there to help out, but the puck recovered by Mason Raymond on the near boards. He plays it softly back into the San Jose zone. Higgins is going to get there. Avoided most of that hit from Bolling. Now Pavelski digs it up the board, left wing side for Klo. 8.5 remaining here in the overtime period. Game five. If the Canucks score, they're on to the Stanley Cup final for the third time in franchise history. If the Sharks score, we have a game six Thursday night at AP Pavilion. Lowell just couldn't control the pass. And Ballard able to clear it for Burrows, and it's out to center ice.
Yeah, tough change for the defense of Vancouver. They only had one man in. That's why there was an odd man break.
Look out here. Burrows bouncing puck coming back was Huskins to prevent what would have been a great scoring chance. Now Wellwood in the corner. Knocked away by Henrik Sedin, but Huskins will chase it down now. Angles it off the glass. Wellwood for Heatley. Heatley pulls up, gets the shot away. Save, and kicked out by Luongo to the far side. Heatley again. Along the boards. Working against Tanev. Tanev knocks the puck away. Hands it off to his partner, Ballard. Out of Burrows. Just showed you he's one of the overtime heroes in these playoffs. Game seven overtime in the first round against Chicago. As Bieksa tried to play it ahead, it was blocked by Marleau and set back behind Luongo. Hamhuis.
You can see how safe Huskins wants to play it twice. Played it just off the glass to make sure he gets it out of the zone.
Hansen gets it back in deep. LaPierre gets there for the Canucks. Rafi Torres protects the puck. Left it for Bieksa, who moved in for the right point. Knocked away, but recovered by Hansen. Sends it in wide in the Emmy. Now Rafi Torres has it. There's 7 minutes remaining in the overtime. Now LaPierre, wraparound, stopped by Niemi, and he holds it there.
Well, the San Jose Sharks have put an incredible amount of pressure here lately on Roberto Luongo. He's made some good saves in tight, and you see White getting a shot from the point. It becomes a dangerous situation for the Sharks. Wellwood with a great chance in the high slot. Heatley with a nice pull-up move right there, and he gets a good scoring chance. So for Roberto Luongo, he's holding the fort. 48 saves.
He has faced 50 shots, 14 here in the overtime. And the faceoff to the left of Niemi.
Got to give San Jose a lot of credit, boy. I know their backs are against the wall and there could be no tomorrow and all that stuff, but they're playing a hard game.
Sabo, that changed direction and sailed over the head of Niemi. Now blocked by Ian White. Chips it off the wall. Blocked by Edler. White gets it back. And lifted by Setoguchi to the near side. Cole couldn't get a glove on it. Now Baleen did a good job to keep Mason Raymond from breaking in with speed.
Yeah, San Jose has played the game that you want to play facing elimination. They always say you have to empty the tank and don't leave anything left by the end of the game. 50 shots on goal. They've had strong work defensively and a lot of offensive push.
Now Huskins plays it ahead. Deflected in by Torrey Mitchell. No ice. You can hear the linesman letting the players know. Now Tanev lost his balance, but so did Mitchell. Wellwood trying to come in there to force Tanev to play it. San Jose players are backing off to try to force Tanev to do something. Now Wellwood. Tanev getting some help from Burrows. Ballard had lost his glove, but he's able to recover it as the Sharks regained back in their own zone.
Really well played by Danny Heatley, who had two of his teammates trapped deep inside the zone. He snuffed out that play in the neutral zone by himself. Shut everything down.
Yeah, good call. Played on the defensive side of the puck.
Now Desjardins gets it to Jamal Mayers. Jamal Mayers turns. Taken away by Rafi Torres. And the coach is at this point going to some players that haven't seen a lot of ice time, trying to get some fresh legs out here. In this overtime, Desjardins, McGinn, and Mayers.
Remember that Ben Ferriero scoring against Detroit. Yeah.
Only played a little over 5 minutes in that game. Chipped off the wall here by McGinn. Sent back the other way and deflected over the glass and out of play.
There's been a couple of close calls in this overtime. Sammy Salo had one of the shots from the point. He just throws it in. It gets redirected by number 17, Kessler, there. And that barely went over the crossbar. There's another look there. Look at the goaltender, Niemi. He has no idea where that is. I don't know if it went off of White as well, but Sammy Salo was the shooter. He had two power play goals in the last game.
You know, Klo got fooled there because Salo looked like he was going around the boards and he fired it on the net. Poe doesn't get any part of that. It goes right through him.
85-39, the shot advantage for San Jose going back to the start of game four. Out to center ice, Mason Raymond. Carries across. Blocks the shot attempt. Douglas Murray did. Then delivers a hit on Higgins. Now here's Stone with it. Across the line, trying to buy some time. He wanted to set it up for Boyle, who was coming late. It was blocked. And then Couture gets it in deep as both teams look to make changes. Bieksa stretch pass deflected by Mason Raymond. Niemi takes a look around. That was anticipated by Daniel Sedin, but recovered nicely by the Sharks. Cloak plays it softly back into the Canucks end. Edler pressured by Setoguchi. Pavelski sends it back toward Luongo. He steers to the side. Here's Edler. Flips it ahead. Off the glove of Vallin. Taken here by White ahead for Pavelski. Could not get it deep. Henrik Sedin now. He couldn't get it by Pavelski, but it's recovered by Rafi Torres. He slides it ahead. Here's Burrows with a shot. Niemi the save, and he holds it there as we're down to 3:35 remaining here in the first overtime.
Any bit of a little break one way or the other looks like it's going to be a game-ending situation. Nice turnover and work in the neutral zone. Rafi Torres gets it to Burrows, who's got some speed, does the right thing, penetrates as far as he can before he's cut off, and throws a good hard wrist shot on net.
He's played a hard game. Burrows has been good.
He's an opportunistic player, unexplosive. Those are the guys that you watch for in an overtime situation. Guys that can break out of the holes like he can.
Faceoff win. Ballard a shot that was blocked, and it ends up out of play.
Ballard would have liked this one to be coming back to him just a little bit faster. This one was rolling and spinning a little bit. He had to wait for it. By the time he waited for it, it ended up... See how it's rolling? Good positioning there, too. And then it's deflected up into the netting.
Yeah, that was Heatley that came out. Got that on the blade.
Mitchell, big face-off win. Douglas Murray angles it off the boards. Mitchell through the legs. Heatley ahead for Wellwood. Back for Heatley. Mitchell just overskates that puck. And Douglas Murray, look out here. Hanson with his speed, chips it to the outside. And Hanson waits, looks across it. Oh, he hit Torres in the back door, and it just went over his stick.
And Heatley deflected that one again. Another terrific defensive play by Heatley.
Out to the line, Ballard slides it back in wide of the San Jose goal as we hit 3 minutes remaining here in the overtime period of game five. Sharks facing elimination. Vancouver looking to get back to the Stanley Cup Finals for just the third time in their 40-year history as Bieksa back to chip along now. And his head up, didn't get it through the neutral zone. Logan Couture winds up for a shot into the glove of Luongo. We will hold it there.
Danny Heatley's done a lot of great things in this game, offensively and defensively, on the attack here. Vancouver will throw the puck in a diagonal pass, and Danny Heatley on the right side of your screen, I believe, deflected that one away. Look at the read. Puts a stick there. Yes, he does get it. That was Rafi Torres, number 13, and he had a whole open side of the net, but Heatley got just enough of that. Very aware out there. You could see he knew exactly where he was and what he wanted to do.
Luongo's lost his goal stick. It's well over to his right. Bieksa realizes that. Oh, boy, Bieksa had to drop the goal stick.
Yeah, he had to. He was just about to play the puck.
Yeah.
Can't have two sticks in your hand if you're going to play the puck.
Well, Luongo still does not have his goal stick. Walkham indicated the referee that the stick was dropped by Bieksa before he played it. So there's no penalty, but now Bieksa picks it up and hands it to Luongo.
I didn't hear much from the San Jose bench to let the players on the ice know that he didn't have his stick. And now that's going to be icing on San Jose. They can't make a change. You know, Roberto Luongo drops his stick a lot. He often will lose his stick. And here on the wraparound there, it looks like it's Couture's skate that knocks the blade of it, and then he loses control. Oh, BX is going to handle it to him, and now the puck's coming his way. And that was close, boy. A player is allowed to grab the stick and hand it to the goaltender. He's not allowed to play the puck with two sticks.
Well, face off to the left of the San Jose goal. 2:03 remaining here in the overtime. Thornton steps out. Couture will step in across from Henrik Sedin. Nice shot by Couture. Hammered up the boards, but blocked by Henrik Sedin. Slides it across the angle. Backhand.
Right toe.
Edler with a high shot. Changes direction and squirts out just wide. Burrows trying to get it back. And now Burrows is looking for a penalty shot call, I think.
Yeah, but he's not in the crease. That's White, who was sitting on it momentarily. Then he had his hand on it, and he did cover it up for a moment. But I didn't see him in the blue paint.
Well, the original call was a high stick. That's a great right pad saved there by Niemi just before that. Here, high stick by Burrows, but it goes off of White.
And that's well played. Yeah, that's well played by White. He's okay in doing what he did there. He's sitting on the edge of the blue paint. The puck is away. It comes back to him. See, it's out of the blue paint. You can't cover the puck in the blue paint if you're not a goaltender. But he didn't do it. He pushed it into Niemi.
And he never palms the puck. He doesn't grab it and hold on to it. You know, raise it above the above the ice as well.
Salo trying to hold this puck in, but it's forced ahead. Pavelski fights off what almost certainly would have been a penalty in regulation. As he was held up. Now a big hit, turnover by Vancouver. Picked up by Pavelski. Knocked away by Luongo. And Henrik Sedin starts it back with Burrows. Daniel Sedin coming up to make it a three-man rush. Henrik for Daniel, and they crisscross. I'm not sure why Daniel went down. Did he run into his brother, or was that a San Jose Shark that got him?
Yeah, there were sticks that were crossed there. That was an inadvertent play. It looks bad. I know the Vancouver fans don't like it, but that's not a trick in my book.
Now Vlasic plays it back the other way. Thompson just gets to it. Hamhuis, as we approach a minute remaining here in the first overtime. Now Huskins getting some help. Picked off though by Torres. Wellwood lost his stick for San Jose. Here is Hanson behind the net. They got Hanson trying to make a play.
They got to get the puck back to the left point. That's it.
That's
up against
done.
Wellwood with no stick.
Now Bieksa sends it in wide. LaPierre with it. Wheels it in front. Blocked by Niemi.
That's a nothing play there. Why not get the puck back to the point again? Wellwood had no stick. They're a long ways from their own bench. Hamhuis is the guy who should have had the puck on his stick. And Vancouver missed a good chance there.
Picked up by the Sharks. Now it comes to Logan Couture. Ahead for Joe Thornton. Just off of his stick with less than 20 seconds remaining in the overtime. Edler falls down. Still able to make a play on the puck. And he got it to a teammate, Kessler, who starts it back down. Higgins for Kessler. Chips it off the glass. Logan Couture plays it up the far side. Higgins tried to get it to the front. Out to the line. Dangerous pass. Intercepted Salo. But time will run out here in the overtime, where shots read 52 for San Jose against Roberto Luongo and 29 shots for Vancouver against Antti Niemi. Players on both sides have given it their all, but they have to give more because we are headed to the second overtime of Game 5 of the Western Conference Final, tied at 2-2. We'll send it back to Hockey Central right after this break.
Time here. Dedication and attention to detail, positioning, playing hard, working hard in all the right areas, executing by the book, getting the puck out when you have to, the way you're supposed to, and when players get a little bit of a chance offensively, everybody wanting to be a hero.
Pavelski dumps it in deep, Zetaguchi on Edler. Blow there as well as that puck deflects off the glass and onto the netting. And the faceoff will remain in the Vancouver zone.
Vancouver has not had much success in this game in getting pucks back to their point, to their defensemen, and getting shots through and getting offense because of that. They're at 30 shots, which seems like a lot, but we're in the second overtime.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, San Jose's at 53 shots.
Faceoffs are dead even, so the Sharks have really battled back after Vancouver dominated early. And the Sharks are going to faceoff win here. Setaguchi tries to cut in, sends it out left point. Bali with a shot, a save by Luongo. Knocked down, set back right through the blue paint. Picked up on the near boards now by Ryan Clough. Tried to get it deep, but it's picked off, and Daniel Sedin lifts it high in the air. Lugged down by Vallin from the defensive zone to the neutral zone, and so that is a hand pass.
That's the play of choice, too, isn't it? The high flipper. There's that first shot there by Vallin, and then the second one on a sharp angle by Pavelski. Luongo really got down, made a nice solid butterfly there, stick on the ice and stopping Nicholas Vallin. Three overtime goals, fellas. Opportunistic defensive defenseman.
Thornton wins that draw from Kessler. Boyle back to get it. Seems like Boyle and Murray have not left the ice here. And a two-on-one could develop. Couture with a shot. Where is it? Luongo able to keep it outside the goal line as it hit his equipment, and then he was leaning backwards, but the puck went out to his right, and the whistle quickly.
He just barely made that save, and he didn't kick out any rebound, which was key. Really nice, quick up pass from Boyle deep inside the zone. Had that rebound come out, that was Joe Thornton steaming in from the far side. Luongo smothers it, eats it, is not sure for a moment.
Yeah.
It was free. Couture actually poked it free, but the referee had lost sight of it.
Yeah. A little premature whistle right there. It looked like he was off his angle just a little bit. That far side was open. But you've got to shoot the puck in that position because the exit, the defenseman, was taking away the pass to the far side. And so the goalie knows he's got the shooter. You know, the last Vancouver Canuck goaltender to go to the finals was Kirk McLean. He wore number one. Not too many number ones win the Stanley Cup, fellas.
Yeah.
The last one being Bernie Perron of the Philadelphia Flyers.
Wow, a while ago. Early 70s.
Mitchell went for the steal, but the Canucks able to clear. Sharks come right back on the attack. Mitchell sends it off the block for Luongo. Wellwood chips it to the corner. Heatley on the cycle. Ballard played him aggressively, and Keith Ballard gets it to center ice. Hands it off now. Rafi Torres takes the shot. Takes it in deeper now. And a collision involving a couple of players, and the net is knocked off behind Niemi. And Stephen Walkham is indicating that it was the Canucks that caused this. And the faceoff's going to come outside the San Jose zone.
Keith Ballard up on the play there. I think he gave a shot to Huskins, and Huskins went backwards into the net, knocking it off his mooring. So we'll have the faceoff outside.
The Sedins and Burrows, Thornton, Couture, and Marlowe. So the two top lines head-to-head here. A little over 5 minutes into the second overtime. Turned over the neutral zone on the Sharks. Burrows couldn't handle it cleanly. Daniel Sedin gets it to Hendrick. Nice takeaway there by Thornton. Plays it up the boards. Couture chips it high in the air. Comes down on the ledge. Shot that by Hamhuis. Daniel Sedin. Accidentally came up high on Ian White. Referee let that go. Marlowe on the far side. Taken away by Henrik Sedin. Now Daniel pinned to the boards by Bahlin. Marlowe angles it off the boards. Couture able to clear it past Hamhuis, and BX is there as both teams will make changes. 6 minutes into this second overtime. Kessler with speed across the line. Cut the... Back comes Pavelski. Flips it in on Luongo and will get another faceoff deep in the Vancouver zone.
Oh, Ryan Kessler is lucky he's still up and able to move, because Douglas Murray had him all lined up. Here's Kessler making the move from the outside in. He loses it for a second. He looks up and great gets hit. Blown away by Murray. Murray comes in. That's a great look at Murray. Seeing the opportunity, seeing what Kessler wants to do coming into the middle and making him pay big time. Love those open ice hits like that.
Arms down, doesn't lunges up. Look like your old partner in Washington, Scott Stevens.
He was one of the best all time at that.
Salo angles the puck along the boards behind Niemi, far side. Douglas Murray there. So is Setoguchi, who clears. Lapierre just off the bench for the Canucks. Rifles it back behind Niemi. Taken by Boyle. And Boyle, one of five members of the San Jose team with a Stanley Cup to his credit. Of course, won it with the Tampa Bay Lightning back in 2004. Luongo off the play this puck. Plays it up the glass. Rafi Torres with it. Drops it back. Out to center ice. White ahead now for Jamal Mayers. Jamal Mayers takes it wide. Backhands it along the end boards. Here is Jamie McGinn with it. McGinn sends it out to the left point. Bahlin, wrist shot blocked by Hansen. Sends it ahead for Rafi Torres. Ballard jumps into the play. Lapierre up there as well. Torres with a shot into the glove of Niemi, and he holds it there.
Let's go back again and take another look at Douglas Murray getting all of Ryan Kessler. Good, clean, really hard hit.
Just an explosion. And you see that Setoguchi actually lost his stick on the play. But for Todd McClellan, the head coach of the San Jose Sharks, he did a good job of getting Desjardins, Jamal Mayers, and McGinn on the ice. And they had some good pressure. Good play by Jamal Mayers to gain the zone, play it back to the point. One thing about that McGinn, if he gets a chance to shoot it, boys, he's got a really good wrist shot. And Roberto wouldn't know much about him. Wouldn't have much of a read on him, of a book on him.
Here is Couture. Cycles it down for Thornton, being watched by Henrik Sedin. The two captains again going head-to-head as they have quite a bit here in this game. Now Bieksa plays it ahead for Daniel Sedin. Sends it back across on the far side. Henrik was heading to the bench, though, to start a line change. Now it's lifted by Huskins. Hamhuis bouncing puck in his feet, able to recover. Sends it around for Bieksa. Mitchell coming down on him, got a piece of the puck. Takes it away, hands it off now for Wellwood. Wellwood, a little toe drag, drops it back. Douglas Murray, a drive, and a change direction just wide of Luongo.
Might have hit Hamhuis right in front.
Oh, and look out! Plassip didn't see the puck. A breakaway for Higgins, a chance to win it! Niemi says no!
He got the paddle down.
Now Mason Raymond, as the Canucks try to keep the pressure on. Higgins to the corner, Kessler. Kessler changes direction on Douglas Murray, plays it around for Ballard. Ballard lets the shot go in wide. It bounces off the back of the net. Knocked down by Torrey Mitchell. He chips it along for Vlasic. Vlasic now for Wellwood. Wellwood able to get it ahead for Heatley. Heatley pushes it past Tanev. Tanev now just trying to buy some time. Wellwood in on the forecheck. Minutes gone by here in the second overtime. Ballard, far side. Rafi Torres with some speed. Puts on the brakes against Setoguchi. Back to the line. Here's Edler. Sends it in front, looking for a redirection by Hansen. Setoguchi colliding there with Rafi Torres. It comes back to the line. Salah with a drive, and that missed the net.
Went off the skate of Boyle.
Yep. Setoguchi overskates the puck. LaPierre, that's turned aside by Niemi. Boyle plays it around on the far side, and then he'll pick it up himself. Klo hands it off to Setoguchi. Play had settled down a little bit, but now it's picking up again.
Well, we've talked about Vancouver D and not getting very many shots, but in that sequence, two big shots from the point.
Now Henrik Sedin across the line. Daniel going for the net. It's knocked away, but right to Edler. Edler's shot was blocked by Pavelski. Henrik Sedin again for Daniel. Sends it back to Henrik in the corner, approaching the halfway mark of the second overtime. Daniel Sedin, high slot shot, knocked down in front of Niemi. Here is Hansen now. Sets it up for Daniel Sedin. It goes through him. Bieksa will hold it in left point. In deep for Henrik Sedin. Pass intended for Daniel. Found its way there. Now Bieksa doesn't shoot. Now he lets it go. Good block by Huskins. Back to the line, Edler. And that puck. An unbelievable situation. It is not reviewable whether the puck hit the netting, but now the officials are discussing it. Certainly the San Jose Sharks thought that it was out of play. And then the puck came back to the line. It was fired into the net behind Niemi, who looked like he had relaxed a little bit.
To me, the puck did look like it went up into the netting. And then all of a sudden it disappeared. It appeared in the net. Goes back to the point. Up and around. Everybody is looking for it.
Everybody stops. Now when we see it come into the frame and it's in the net.
I still have no idea what happened there. Oh, all the way back to the point and the shot from the point.
Well, nobody is arguing from the San Jose Sharks, and they have started the handshakes.
There was so much misdirection there. Edler? Was that Edler from the point or Bieksa?
Kevin Bieksa was the one that took the shot.
Here's Edler on the right side of your screen.
There's where it goes up the glass. Hits the stanchion.
Oh, it hits the stanchion, and Bieksa shoots it.
Nobody could see it. That was the first angle that showed us what really happened. Players on both sides were looking around, but Kevin Bieksa is going to be the overtime hero here in Game 5 and send the Vancouver Canucks to the Stanley Cup Finals for the third time in their history and the first time since 1994. What a bizarre ending.
A strange set of circumstances. Everybody on the ice except for Bieksa lost sight of it, didn't know where it was. And that one replay, you could see Burrows in behind the net looking for it. Where the heck is it? And then he sees it in the net. Niemi had no idea. There's Edler. This is where we lost it. He shoots it around. It hits the stanchion, and it's already coming back out in the slot. Look at all the players.
Look at Pavelski. See, Pavelski raised his hands, and that's what I reacted to.
And Niemi still has no idea. And all of a sudden, he sees it go by his left leg. Bieksa, the only guy in the rink that knew where it was.
Henrik Sedin is standing by with Darren Pang.
Thanks very much.